Davis champion Niels Christian Iversen stood on top of the podium in Cardiff, Great Britain, as winner of round four of this year's World Championship. The Millennium Stadium was packed with over 40,000 fans as our Warriors of Shale were firstly introduced in a spectacular opening ceremony. Once the lights went up, they battled for points and places to reach a final in what was said to be one of the best prepared temporary race services of recent times. Current championship leader Ty Buffington carried the hopes of the British fans, and despite running a last in his opening ride, fought hard all night to book his place in the final. He'd be joined there by two-time winner in Cardiff, Chris Holder, who showed good race pace throughout the meeting, and two Danes, Peter Killerman, who now has replaced Poland's Jara Campbell for the rest of the season, and Iversen himself. The favoured Redgate gave the start that Holder needed in the final, closely followed in blue by Woffenden, but it was Iversen in white taking the wider line out of turn two that gave him the speed to pass Woffenden and Holder into turn three. A lead that he kept until the chequered flag.
I knew the line outside was gonna work. I had the speed in my bike, and I just had to build the speed. You know, if I made a decent start, I was definitely in it. And things fell in place, and it just worked out to my advantage. So that was good.
So the championship looks like this after four rounds. Despite no podium place in Cardiff, Britain's Ty Woffenden has extended his lead over Denmark's Nicky Pedersen by 12 points. Current world champion Greg Hancock is a further four behind Pedersen in third, with Cardiff winner Iversen now in fourth.
It's about scoring points, and you know, we're not even halfway through yet, so there's so many more opportunities for everyone else to get points, and you know, I've just got to get my head down and do the job that I need to do.
Obviously we know Ty is going good. But as I said, I look towards myself, and I know myself, if things going my way, then I can be fighting for the championship.
We all want to win, and points are the name of the game in the end of it. But, you know, points make prizes, but, you know, it can take time, and I'm here for the long road. I want to win the championship.
So the championship moves to the Baltics, Daugavpils, Latvia. It's the seventh time the series has visited the country's second largest city, and it's a track the riders like. 2014 saw Poland's Krzysztof Kasperzak take the victory, but recent form has seen the likeable Pole drop away from contention in the World Championship. So what's been the issue in 2015?
Now I do the same in the winter like last year, but I don't know. We do everything the best what we can do. But today practice looks good, and I'm very fast, and I feel good. I use the same engine like last year, the John Z1, I hope so. Make me good points.
Hi there, and a very warm welcome to Daugavpils here in Latvia. It's the Rio Tumo Bank Latvian FIM Speedway Grand Prix from the Locomotive Stadium, Daugavpils. And we are looking forward to what could be a terrific meeting here. Fantastic crowd, good atmosphere. Kelvin Tatum is alongside me once again. Kelvin, you've had a look at the track. It's a purpose-built speedway track here in Daugavpils. It has all the ingredients of a great night ahead.
Absolutely, Nigel, and we've got some cloud cover now. It was really sunny earlier on, and the track was drying out very quickly, and it's a very loamy, sandy material here, and this cloud cover is just going to keep the moisture in it and should keep the racing conditions nigh on perfect. Big, fast track, 373 metres, really is a super racing track. We've seen some terrific action here in the past. And as always, a great turnout by the Latvian crowd and a super atmosphere.
Yeah, and we're really looking forward to the third race of the night when it's the top two alongside each other on the grid. Ty Woffenden off gate two and Nicky Pedersen off gate three. That is coming up in heat number three. But for now, the riders making their final preparations for the first race of the night. Here we see Mats Janowski with Michael Jepsen Jensen, who has just hovered around the top eight so far. And this, the fifth round of 12 rounds in the World Championship. We go to Sweden next Saturday and Melilla, which will actually be the halfway stage of the World Championship. So an important phase of the season, Kelv.
Yeah, these two meetings back to back, you can't afford to slip up, because you could find yourself well outside the top eight or losing ground on the World Championship leader. Good opening race here. And Magic Janowski on screen there, blue helmet colour, coming out of gate two in the opening ride. Poor Cardiff. And he's been in great form. He's the Polish champion, bounced back by winning his national championship. And he needs a big meeting this evening.
Yeah, and Mats Janowski, as you mentioned, poor performance in Cardiff, just 3 points. Mm. Natural fact, Janowski now has just hit double figures once in the series so far this year. So, riders make their way out onto this Locomotive Stadium circuit here in Daugavpils.
and we prepare for the action ahead. Heat number one coming up here in Latvia. Here we go, really looking forward to tonight's action. Jason Doyle going off the inside then from Australia in that eighth place right now in the World Championship. Matt Sejanovski goes off gate two in blue. Matty Zegar of Slovenia, he goes off gate number three, his fifth in the championship right now. And Michael Jepsen-Jensen off the outside. Kelvin Tatum, former England World Cup winner, former world finalist, former world long track champion alongside me. Kelvin, we had a good look at the track a little bit earlier. You mentioned the cloud cover, you mentioned baking heat earlier. It has all the makings of a super fast racetrack.
Indeed it does, Nigel. Track conditions nigh on perfect. Will be a little bit slick early on, but it will make some dirt. But this is a big fast track. You need horsepower here. You need to get off those tapes. A long drag to the first corner. Here we go.
Here we go, heat number one. And it's a good start from Janowski off two. Can Doyle hold the line? Yes, he can. And a lovely switch up the inside. Matty Zegar in white. That was magnificent. And look how close they are on the back straight as Doyle charges up the inside in red now. Super move from the Australian. He's taken Zegar wide. Janowski is charging hard up the inside of Zegar now as well. What an opening lap of a Grand Prix that was.
Terrific stuff from Doyle. Really forceful move as they went into turns three and four in the opening lap. Got a little bit beaten up. He went too wide initially and Zegar took advantage, but then Zegar got passed by Doyle and Janowski then pounced as well and has got himself nicely into second place. Jepsen-Jensen's out the back, but Jason Doyle made a couple of mistakes in Cardiff. He looks like he's really intent on making up for them in his opening ride here.
Yeah, it's his first full season as a Grand Prix rider. He's got that eighth place right now. Remember, the top eight qualify automatically for the 2016 series. And this is going to be a big win for him. He's under a little bit of pressure from Matt Sejanovski, the pole.
Yep.
He won't give up for sure. But into turns three and four for the final time. Doyle holds the line nicely. And it's a big win to get us underway. Jason Doyle from Matt Sejanovski in second. Third place in white was the one-time leader there, Matty Zegar. And Michael Jepsen-Jensen at the back, but Doyle knew he had to work hard for that victory. It was a real cut and thrust opening lap of that race.
Yeah, Doyle just ran wide going in the first turn. It was very tight between him and Janowski as they got there, and the door opened up for Zegar, but Zegar couldn't hang on to the lead. Doyle recovered, won in fine style.
Yep, good ride indeed from Jason Doyle with Matt Sejanovski second. Matty Zegar was third. Michael Jepsen-Jensen at the back. That's your result of the opening race of the night, and a super win for Jason Doyle. Moves him on to 32 points in the series overall now. Had a fine round, Jason Doyle, in the second round in Tampere with 11 points. And he really had to work hard here off the inside.
And we'll see it. He's neck and neck with Janowski. They run a little wide. And that opens the door for Zegar, who switches to the inside. A nice move from him, but Doyle's forceful here. He generates a lot of pace down the back straight. We're seeing it again with Janowski making a good jump initially, and then they're handlebar to handlebars. They get to the first corner between Doyle and Janowski. They run wide. That leaves the door open for Zegar. Jepsen-Jensen's there momentarily, but has no pace and gets relegated to the back. But the move here now, we'll see it down the back straight from Doyle. This is the key to the race.
It's a great
wheels
shot
in line, super racing here. Allows the bike to run hard underneath the Slovenian Zegar, runs him a little bit wide, and that allows Janowski then to pounce and come through into second place. Doyle will be pleased with that. That's a nice way to start your evening's work.
No doubt our friends in Australia and his fans in the UK of the Leicester Lions will be delighted with that to get us underway here in Daugavpils, the Rio Tumu Bank Latvian FIM Speedway Grand Prix, round five of 12, and this man no doubt will be really looking forward to the final round of the year in his home country, Australia.
Yes.
As the Grand Prix returns to Australia in Melbourne. Now, Andreas Johnsen, last-minute change of bike.
Another rider that had a very disappointing Grand Prix in Cardiff, was a bit shell-shocked afterwards. Didn't quite understand what had happened, but a late change of equipment there. He's gone for his second bike, one practice start, and has jumped off the initial choice and has gone for his second choice. Fingers crossed it works out for him.
It's Greg Hancock off the inside, third in the World Championship right now, but the reigning champion, of course, Thomas H. Jonasson of Sweden, gate two in blue. Got married in the week, congratulations to him. Troy Batchelor off gate three in white of Australia, and Andreas Johnsen going off the outside in yellow. Batchelor back after injury, the knock that he took in Cardiff. He missed a British match for Swindon, but returned for them on Monday. Here we go, heat number two, and Hancock's made a great start from the inside gate. Now he locks up. Batchelor! Thought Jonasson was going to collect his back wheel, and Batchelor now is coming hard round the outside. This is a great ride from Troy Batchelor, but Hancock knows the line to take. That allows Batchelor the opportunity to try the inside run.
Well,
he's got the speed, and he's taken Hancock, and Jonsson's having a go on the inside now.
Oh! Jonsson backs it in, very nearly clouts the back of Greg Hancock. Super speed showed by Troy Batchelor, already pulling away. Great opening lap of speedway from the Australian. Got to say that Jonsson missed the start completely, and Hancock's got problems. Do believe he's got a punch. He's got a puncher. That's really has. He's changed away from the Golden Tar, gone to the Mitas Tar, and that's really disappointing start for the world champion. But Batchelor, out in front. Terrific speed shown by him.
He had more speed than Hancock in the first lap, it had to be said. And Batchelor is riding quite beautifully. Hancock's race is over with that puncher. And he, remember, is third in the standings, but he won't have to his 39 points tonight. Troy Batchelor looking super smooth here from Australia. So we've got an Australian winner in the opening two races of the night. Batchelor from Andreas Jonsson in second, who almost lost control of the bike. Jonsson, who had to work hard to avoid the back wheel of Hancock early on. And Hancock retired there with that puncher. So two races, two Australian wins here.
Nice ride
in Davopils. It was a super ride. He had lots of speed, didn't he?
He did, yeah. The speed down the back straight on the opening lap was very impressive. He had the better of the world champion. And Jonsson, oh, out of shape, but he hung on for second place.
Batchelor, Jonsson and Jonasson is the finishing order there in heat number two. And a good start to the Grand Prix.
Yeah, it's a little slick, but it's high-speed action, and we're seeing it again. Initially, Hancock makes a good start. No surprise in that. Thomas H. Jonasson a little bit out of shape, and he gets relegated to the back. But look at the speed from Batchelor. Down that back straight, he generates plenty of speed, gets the momentum coming out of the first corner. And he'll be delighted with that. Had a nasty fall in Cardiff, of course, where he had to miss some racing, but it's bounced back well. And he's just enough racing room there. He then chops back to the inside, coming out of turn four as they complete the first lap. And you can see there he's got to the front. Jonsson out of shape. Very nearly ran in the back of Andreas Jonsson there. And he does well, actually, to maintain control of the bike. He's momentarily out of control and then regains control and has a look at Thomas H. Jonsson. But unfortunately for the world champion, he gets a puncher and does not score. Troy Batchelor comfortably out in front.
Yeah, a blow for Greg Hancock to start with here, but Batchelor brilliant as we build up to heat number three, and it is the showdown between the top two riders in the world coming out here in heat number three. Nothing Hancock can do about that. He's got to forget about that and move on to the next one now. Heat number three is coming up. We have the world championship leader Ty Wolfenden going off gate two, and the second place man Nicky Pedersen, 12 points behind him in the championship, is alongside him in gate number three. Not to mention this fella, Peter Killerman, who has now had five Grand Prix meetings in his career and has reached the final in three of them. And we've got the wild card, Kas Podzuks, the Latvian, off the outside. What a lineup this is. Killerman off the inside, Wolfenden the championship leader, gate two. Pedersen goes off gate three, 12 adrift of Wolfenden. And Podzuks a wild card. He'll be up for this off gate four here in heat number three.
Well, Podzuks came in at the last minute last year for Darcy Ward and rode very well. He knows this place extremely well. Of course, he rides for the club in the Polish League, so there's not a grain of shale he doesn't understand or hasn't ridden over. So won't be a surprise if he does well, but it's a good clash here in gates two and three.
Yep, here we go, heat number three, and Pedersen has made a beauty. He has made a storming start, and now Wolfenden tries the inside line. Wolfenden has made a clever move to charge up the inside of Peter Killerman there. Pedersen has the lead. Pedersen looking quick. Wolfenden's going to chase hard after him now, but Nicky Pedersen of Denmark, a super ride here. Wolfenden's all over him. Killerman is third, and Podzuks is the man at the back, but Wolfenden looks to have a lot of speed here.
Yeah, he's got tons of speed in second place. The bike spun up initially off the start, just didn't get away very well, whereas Pedersen did. Got to say, Pedersen's having to ride a very good line here, because there's no question Wolfenden has an awful lot of speed in second place. Kuhlman back in third, and Podzuks out the back, but Nicky Pedersen just about hanging on to the lead. Has Wolfenden got anything? Can he do something about the three-time former world champion out in front?
Well, he really is winding it on, but I think Pedersen's done enough here. It's a super ride from the day. Nicky Pedersen, three times world champion, down the back straight. He's opening up that lead. He's going to claw a point back in the championship on Ty Wolfenden. Long way to go tonight. First of five outings to qualify for the semi-finals. Pedersen, Wolfenden, Kilderman and Podzuks. But that was a good recovery from Wolfenden, because he span and he was left at the start, but he managed to dive up the inside and pull off a good move. But what about this fella, Nicky Pedersen, on form and a jet-propelled getaway?
Yeah, no surprise in that, but I've got to say he showed good speed out in front and a clever line he rode. Woofendon, for 2.5 laps at least, had more speed and was looking for a way through, but Pedersen, well, in the end, he won relatively comfortably in a very accomplished ride from the three-time former champ.
Yeah, Pedersen, Woofendon, Kilimanjaro and Podsouks. Great ride from Nicky Pedersen then. Moves him on to 46 Grand Prix points. He's 11 behind Woofendon now, but a long, long way to go. And see Woofendon, how far back he is at the start here.
Yeah, well, the bike just doesn't get any grip at all, and it's a good move from him in the first corner to react. You can see the team there just really cheering him on. Once again, this is Podsouks on the outside. But look at Pedersen out of gate three. That's an excellent start from him. He's comfortably in front. As I say, for the championship leader, Ty Woofendon reacts very quickly here, gets the better of Kilderman around that first corner, and as they roar down the back straight, it's nice and tight. But then Woofendon actually shows great speed, and I thought for a moment he may well get the better of Pedersen out in front, but all credit to the Danish rider, he maintains a very good line. He makes it hard work for Woofendon to make any ground, and in the end, it's the Danish man that comes away with the 3 points.
Yeah, Pedersen, who did say actually after his Swedish league fixture on Tuesday night, he was pleased for a couple of days off because he was feeling the effects of cold and flu. But no ill effects here in heat number three here in Dowager Pills tonight. Lovely start from Pedersen. Heat four coming up now. Here we see Chris Harris of Great Britain in the blue helmet colour. Niels Christian Iversen, winner in Cardiff a fortnight ago. Christoph Kasperzak, winner here last year. We've got Chris Holder in this race as well, the 2012 world champion. Kasperzak off the inside. It's birthday today. Can he get off to a winning start? Harris goes off gate two in blue. Iversen off gate three in white. And Holder is the man off the outside in yellow.
Yeah, and Chris Holder had an excellent Cardiff. So very nearly came to win there. Had the inside gate for the final, but couldn't quite resist the charge of the man who's just underneath him in the gate three in the white helmet colour, Niels Christian Iversen, who I say came up with a fabulous performance in the end. And one in fine style. Kasperzak's been out of form. Winner here last year. Needs to recapture some of that if he's going to make a charge for the top eight.
Yeah, Kasperzak well down in 13th in the World Championship, and a little bit of movement at the start. We look for a red light. It's been allowed to continue, and a bit of movement in the first. Now the red flags are up. The red lights are on. Yep, it was hard to see in the sunshine, to be fair. As the sun
looks
beats
like
down here.
Possibly Harris moved a little bit, but no doubt that Marek Wojciech, the Polish referee, unhappy with the way that the boys got away from the tapes, and we'll have a little delay now. The track is drier than I thought it was going to be, in actual fact. We are seeing some plumes of dust being kicked up by the back wheels. We'll see it again across the tapes. This will be ideal. No, Iversen.
Iversen moved.
Yep. Iversen moved initially, and Harris a little bit as well subsequently. And both of the boys a bit too keen to get underway. And Iversen gains an advantage. Sometimes you'll see a rider actually move, and then he actually penalises himself and the referee will let it go, and that's right in that circumstances. But Iversen actually gained an advantage by being a bit too eager.
2 minutes on, the 2 minute time allowance. Phil Morris, the Speedway Grand Prix race director, wasting no time in putting the 2 minute time allowance on there as we build up to the restart of Heat 5. He will know that he played his part in the stoppage of that race. Niels Christian Iversen, fantastic display it was in that final in Cardiff.
Yes.
14 points he scored overall in the meeting, but what a move it was.
It was.
In the
had
final.
A touch of good fortune about it, because Holder had to make a decision going to the first corner, and he decided to look after Woofendon in the first corner. And of course, there was a little bit of racing room around the outside, which he took full advantage of. And after the disappointment for Iversen in the World Cup, he really was down in the dumps after that mistake he made in the last race, which cost them the World Cup effectively. To come back with such a big performance like that showed a tremendous amount of character. So, yeah, I'm sure he's feeling a lot more confident about his racing now.
Well, he admitted he made a mistake, Iversen, but he shouldn't beat himself too much over the World Cup because, you know, it's a team effort. And at the end of the day, as a team, Denmark didn't do enough. That's the bottom line.
Absolutely, but, you know, he could have had it. He had it, didn't he? And he just... Yes. Just went a little bit too hard at the beginning of the race, but what a performance it was in Cardiff. And he's just got to be a bit more patient now, and the boys have just got to be sit still and get away cleanly.
Marek Wojciech then, the man with his finger on the button here in Dowager Pills tonight, going off the inside. Christoph Kasperzak with Chris Harris off two. Niels Christian Iversen goes off three, and Chris Holder going off the outside. After this race, every rider will have had one outing here in Daugavpils this evening. About a three-hour drive from Riga here, Daugavpils. Pretty close to the Russian border, it has to be said. A lot of people here in this town speak Russian. So we build up to heat number four then now. Will they behave this time? Oh, it was very nervy as the referee kept the takes down for quite some time, and Iversen has made a beauty. Niels Christian Iversen is there now. Can Holder come around the outside? Holder almost off, had to get off the bike there. This is a good race going into three and four. Iversen, though, knows the line. Now Holder will try the inside switch. Here he comes. Lovely move. Chris Holder, absolutely stunning exhibition speedway from the 2012 world champion. Iversen second, Harris third, and the out of form, Christoph Kasperzak at the back once again.
Fabulous move from Chris Holder there. Just switched to the inside coming out of the last corner on the opening lap and swept to the front. Iversen initially good away from the tapes. Harris there battling hard. He's back in third place. Looks like he's got a bit of speed as well. Kasperzak is tailed off, but Chris Holder has had a hard season. He struggled for confidence at the beginning of it. But I tell you what, Cardiff seems to have boosted his confidence and he's riding very well out in front.
Yeah, he is. He's looking very, very quick here down the back straight. Chris Holder in the last lap of heat number four. Had a terrific meeting at the Millennium Stadium. And now carrying it forward with a fine ride here. Heat four, Chris Holder, Niels Christian Iversen in second place. Chris Harris of Great Britain was third. And Christoph Kasperzak, well and truly at the back. His birthday candle has been well and truly blown out with that race.
Yes.
Christoph Kasperzak, but Chris Holder,
yes,
simply superb.
Absolutely, out of the top draw there. Sweet move at the end of the first lap to get the better of Iversen. And there's no question, once he hit the front, he showed tremendous speed and he'll be chuffed to bits with his opening ride. No question about that.
So the winners of the first four heats, Nicky Pedersen, Chris Holder, Troy Batchelor, and Jason Doyle, four gone here in Daugavpils. That's the latest.
Yeah, nice ride from Chris Holder, and a bit of congratulations going on there in the pits, and we'll soon see why. It's initially Iversen who makes the best of it to the first corner. Holder's got speed, you can see he's working hard already, and he feels the bike underneath him as they go down the back straight. He knows that the speed is there. Iversen again. He gets the best of it initially to the first corner. Holder there, just battling hard down that back straight. It's tight, and this is a nice mood. Iversen runs in tight, allows the bike to come up the banking, and Holder reads it beautifully, sweeps to the inside, and they don't see which way he goes. He shows really a good speed out in front. And I'll tell you what, this is really encouraging for Chris Holder, the former world champion, who has had all sorts of injury problems in the last couple of years. Yep, there once again, great pictures. The Australian out in front and thoroughly enjoyed it, I'm sure.
Good ride then from Chris Holder. He's out in the next one in heat five. What a lineup. Holder, Doyle, Hancock, Pedersen. You've got three world champions in heat five next.
Three heat winners as well.
Yes, and Jason Doyle, who won the first race of the evening here. Crowd enjoying it. It's a lovely, hot, sunny evening here in Daugavpils. Around about 20 past seven in the evening. 2 hours ahead of the UK here in Latvia. Bit of track grading going on, but a nice atmosphere and the smell of the barbecued meat
is indeed
reverberating around the commentary box.
Certainly is, and it's got to be, there's a smashing atmosphere in. Super sound hit system here that adds to the whole sense of occasion. Decent start to the meeting with really high speed stuff, which is no surprise. It's a big, fast track, a little bit slick. But riders will get the bikes dialed in, there's no question about that. But very encouraging for the Australians in the first four races. Three heat winners from Australia. Doyle, Batchelor and Holder really looking good on these fast tracks. And the Aussies have started in fine style, which will please their supporters no end. Pedersen coming out with a nice win over Ty Woofenden, who pushed him really hard. Disappointing for Greg Hancock, of course, with the puncher, and he'll be looking to bounce back in his second ride.
Well, Ty Woofenden, who had lots of speed, he's speaking now to Steve Brandon.
Ty spun up on the start, but plenty of speed once the race got going.
Yeah, it felt good, but it feels like it's dying a little bit coming off the corners, so just making a little change, and hopefully I make some better starts than that.
I won't ask you what it was, because I mightn't understand, but just the speed on the track, very promising, but Nicky rode quite an intelligent race in front of you as well. Didn't really give you any chance to get a purchase in the corners.
Yeah, he rode a good race, but he was in front, you know. That's what you do when you're in front. You just ride the line you want. And normally when someone's in front, they ride the perfect line. And I was trying to ride the not perfect line to pass him. So, yeah, that's racing.
Are you conscious of the fact that now it's just about building points, keeping the momentum going on the scoreboard?
Yeah, that's it, mate. That's all I've got to do now. Is I think there's 6 rounds to go after this. And, yeah, just keep more opportunities to keep scoring points. So it'll be good.
Long way to go tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, the next round is next Saturday, back-to-back Grand Prix with Melilla in Sweden. Next Saturday night, it's very demanding for the mechanics, the technical setups of the logistical setups of the riders with the league racing in the week, and then Melilla next weekend is a very demanding there.
It is. The travelling is intense and long distances between meetings and Polish league, of course. So, yeah, it's a tough period of time for the riders and mechanics.
Well, Greg Hancock, so unlucky in his opening ride. He's with Steve now.
Greg, never a great time to get a puncture, but that was probably the worst in your first ride.
Yeah, I mean, it's like you said, there's never a good time, but, you know, you got to take these things in racing, and let's hope it's the last one.
I mean, you probably didn't get a chance to feel how the bike was going in that heat, but, you know, happy with where you're at, and you just got to pick up some points now.
Yeah, great. Practice was great yesterday, and I felt good from the first start and the first half a lap there, and then I could feel it started to go pretty much immediately, and just tried to ride the best I could, knowing that I was probably doomed somewhere.
And people may not have seen the whole series if they're watching tonight. Another different race suit this time?
Yeah, that's right. At Redline Oil, and my great sponsors, they stepped up again, too, and they wanted to have the Grand Prix all to themselves, and, you know, I'm pretty proud that there's a lot of people that want to be involved.
All right, and plenty more points to go tonight?
Yeah, there's a lot of more points to be had, and, you know, right now I got to work hard.
Thanks for your time.
A lot of track work going on, as you would expect, the track grading, but it's a different type of surface here, Kelvin. It looks very sandy, and
it is.
And they've done quite a bit of watering now.
And although
well.
There's not lots of it, it's yeah. quite surprising how it saps the power out of the bike, and you will need to have plenty of grunt in the bike to drag you to the first corner. So bike setup, once again, is always challenging, and it will change from this week to next week, of course, which is another super speedway track in Melilla. But not quite as big as this one. Plenty of water going on, which I think is wise, because there were some plumes of dust there in those opening four races. It was very warm earlier today, and the track did dry out, so quite possibly they do need to keep an eye on that. But as I say, high-speed action, and the track is quite slick, so bike setup going to be absolutely vital. Ty Wolfenden saying he just needs to make a small tweak to the bike. It was just dying a little bit coming off the corners. Quite interesting how in tune Ty Wolfenden is with his equipment. Talking to him on several occasions, really does have a very good understanding of how the bike works now, and I'm sure that is one of the reasons why he's having such a good run. And I fully expect him to win some races here this evening, and I just get the feeling that was a nice little taster. That was a bit of a starter for us, wasn't it, Nice? Because I think this meeting will get really quite exciting.
There was some good action in the opening four heats, no doubt. And here we see the standings with Wolfenden on 57 now, Nicky on 46, Greg on 39. And there we see the top eight. Jarek Hampel just hanging on in there in eighth place, although it's very unlikely he'll ride again this season, of course. But Jason Doyle on 32. He would be absolutely delighted if he ended this season in the top eight and automatically booked his place next year.
Absolutely, and he's more than good enough to do that. Just needs to row out a couple of little impetuous mistakes, and I'm sure he'll achieve that. This man we're looking at, Kasper Zak, he has had a desperate season. I don't know what's gone wrong. Rode so well last year, finished second in the world, and then suddenly has found it awfully difficult to get amongst the points, and that was evident again, once again, in heat number four, where came away from the inside and didn't land a blow. So yeah, a tough time for Kasper Zak, and speedway can be a tough game when your bikes and you're just not clicking and your confidence is low.
Well, riders coming out then for a mouth-watering heat number five. It really is. Looking forward to seeing this one with those three world champions and a race winner in Jason Doyle of the opening race of the night. So, heat number five coming up, race winners so far, and Jason Doyle in heat one, Troy Batchelor heat two, Nicky Pedersen heat three, and Chris Holder is a race winner as well. So three race winners here, and the triple world champion Greg Hancock. This is heat five. Here we go, Chris Holder going off the inside then. What a lineup it is. It's Jason Doyle going off gate number two, Greg Hancock gate three, and Nicky Pedersen off the outside in yellow. It is quite a mouth-watering lineup, this one.
Yeah, super lineup for heat number five. And as you rightly said, that three heat winners here, world champions left, right, and centre. Doyle, of course, he won't be intimidated by this. He's a confident man these days. And the Australian started very well in the opening four races with three wins out of four, so they'll be pleased with that. Holder and Doyle working very hard with their gardening on the start line, particularly Holder now, he's off the side of the bike. Hancock, of course, under pressure right from the word go, failing to score first time out. He'll be looking to jet propel out of gate three and get himself to the front, but yeah, smashing lineup.
Yeah, reminder, it's back-to-back GPs with Melilla next weekend, a fantastic track there in the Forest in Sweden, really looking forward to that. But here in Daugavpils now, this is a big heat number five. What a lineup it is. We await Marek Wojciech's finger on the button for the green light and the tape tries. Who's going to emerge from the start? It's a close one there with Holder up the inside, and now here comes Nicky Pedersen. Lovely move from Pedersen. The lead though is with Jason Doyle. Hancock comes through into second, Pedersen is third. Now Holder will have a go at the back here, but it's the lead is with Jason Doyle magnificently. Hancock second, Pedersen third, and Chris Holder having a go at the back.
Well, once again a very hotly contested first corner, and Jason Doyle showing great confidence. Absolutely committed as they got there, and he made that first corner and the lead his. Hancock responding well, looking fast in second place. Pedersen has tailed off, and Chris Holder, who won so very impressively in his opening ride, is struggling here and he's out the back. But Jason Doyle, winner of heat number one, coming out of gate number two in heat number five, is looking good. Hancock with a lap to go. Can he find a way through?
Well, he's putting pressure on Doyle here. Doyle with the lead. Hancock is second. And now Pedersen's gone wide. Holder is right up the exhaust pipe of Nicky Pedersen for third. But what a ride from Jason Doyle. He's going to get 6 points on the board. Holder's tried the outside run on Pedersen. Not enough there. Pedersen hangs on for the point. But it's Doyle from Hancock. Superb stuff from Jason Doyle. Two rides, two wins, and what a race to win. Seven world titles between the three other riders that he was up against there, and he's won it magnificently with a super effort in heat number five, and he goes on to a maximum 6 points out of six. Doyle, Hancock, Pedersen, Holder. Superb stuff from Doyle. Rockets up to the top of the table now.
Yeah, and in fine style, got to say, it was a really closely contested run to the first corner. They were really tight. We'll see it again. Pedersen just a little bit keen to get away. Doyle, Holder and Hancock all getting their three abreast, but it's a good move initially, I thought, from Pedersen. I sense that he might well be able to hang on to second places, but when they go down the back straight, that man, the world champion, just shows a little bit more speed. Look how close that was, and Jason Doyle just had a little bit in hand here. The bike digs in and drives down the back straight, and that's a super feeling. Good out in front, chased hard by Hancock. Holder had speed, but just could not get amongst the points after just not getting away from the inside gate very well at all. But Doyle, what a night he's having so far. Two wins to his name. Very impressive.
Well, only the fifth Grand Prix of Doyle's career. This is Hancock's 184th. Puts that in perspective, doesn't
he? He's only missed one, isn't he, since 95. Smashing start, though, for Doyle. I'm pleased for him. He's a bit of a breath of fresh air, and the Australians will be delighted with his start to tonight.
Yep, here we go with heat number six. Doyle still hugely popular with Somerset in the UK as well, where he made a name for himself in the second tier of British racing with the Somerset Rebels, Jason Doyle, but now with Leicester Lions in the top flight. Here we go with heat number six. Chris Harris goes off the inside in red. Peter Killerman goes off to Maciej Janowski, gate three in white, and a race winner from his opening ride, Troy Batchelor, off the outside in yellow.
Yeah, and very impressively, he had showed great speed and won comfortably in the end. Janowski was decent in his opening ride. He was able to get into second place, an opportunist move at the end of the first lap that saw him get into that second place. Harris on the inside showed reasonable pace. He had a third place. And of course, Peter Kilderman is a hard charger. So once again, a Grand Prix lineup with plenty of quality.
Yep, here we go with heat number six. Oh, Janowski. Do you know what? He is starting to do that quite regularly, Kelvin. We've seen it in league racing.
Doesn't need to either.
No.
Generally, he's an excellent starter and has been in decent form, but probably just, well, it's normally an indication the rider's nervous.
Well, it's starting to become an Achilles heel of Matt Cianowski. Really.
It's something that you don't really want to keep doing. Referee is holding the tapes a fraction long, possibly, but quite clearly you can see Janowski moving.
Yeah, such is the pressure. Well, there was maybe a bit of movement from Batchelor as well.
Yeah, maybe that caused the problem for Janowski. When you're looking across the front wheel of another rider and it moves, it can make you move as well. And you do see from time to time that riders can be sort of sucked into the tapes and get excluded by a rider alongside you moving. Chains just being readjusted, clutches being cuddled down. 2 minutes won't be far away.
Is Wojciech holding the tapes too long?
Fractionally, yes.
Why does he do that?
To try
and prove a point, I'm in charge.
He's
behave
about
yourself.
25 metres down there. Nice, pop along and have a ask him. I don't know. It's almost like he's waiting for somebody to move, and that's unnecessary.
Well, heat number six. I dare say there are some referees who do like to stamp their authority and say, look, I'm the boss. This meeting's all about me, not you.
Well, it shouldn't be, should it? should be about the 16 fellas doing the action on the track.
Absolutely. Heat number six coming up then here. Will they get away first time? Maybe being a bit harsh on Janowski there, because there was movement from this fella, Batchelor. Anyway, unsatisfactory start. All four riders back for another restart here in heat number six here in Daugavpils. Good start to the meeting, though. Some good racing.
Good start, and I know why the riders are nervous on the start line, because it's a long way to the first corner. The track's quite slick, and it's quite clear that you need to make your move early, and if you can get off the first corner with your nose in front, there's a very good chance you'll stay there. So a massive emphasis once again at this high level of the sport to get to the first corner, to make a good getaway, and quite clearly riders are a bit tense, and that is definitely, you know, if the tapes are just held for a fraction of a second longer than you're accustomed to, it feels like an eternity. And possibly that's what's causing riders to be a little bit impatient, but we'll see.
Yep, be interesting to see how long he holds the tapes down this time. Heat number six it is. Second time of asking. Green light on. And away they go, and into the first turn. Batchelor from gate four, brilliant. Gets the drop on Janowski. It's a long way from that gate four. Janowski now charges up the inside, the pole, and coming through into third place in blue is Peter Killerman. And Killerman's spectacular. He's going to have a go around the outside. Look at him go. Batchelor with the lead. Janowski closes the door for second. Killerman is third. And Chris Harris is at the back, but they're all bunched up, particularly at the front here, with Janowski heaping the pressure on Troy Batchelor.
Yes, he is. It was a good start initially from Batchelor. Once again, from the outside, you're right, Nigel. It's a long way from there, and Batchelor's having a good night like Jason Doyle, and he's out in front. It looks like he could go unbeaten after his first two rides. Kilderman was spectacular in the opening lap, and Harris has been tailed off out the back, but Troy Batchelor back from injury, a nasty incident he had in Cardiff, and I tell you what, he's enjoying a really good night. Janowski charging hard in second place, but he can't do anything about the Australian.
Yeah, Batchelor's got a lot of speed for sure. Harris loses control of the bike just a little bit at the back, and his race is done, you feel now. Troy Batchelor of Australia then is going to take the chequered flag, and like Jason Doyle, his fellow countryman, it's two rides and two wins, and from gate four, that is a super effort from Troy Batchelor. At second place there, Matt Cianowski, and third in blue, Peter Killerman. And looking at it from Troy Batchelor's point of view, these 6 points tonight are a major boost for him, because he was in 14th place before tonight's meeting on 17. He's now moved on to 24 GP points, and a few more tonight will put him right in contention for a top eight place. Batchelor, Janowski and Killerman was the finishing order, and it means that Batchelor and Doyle are the two unbeaten riders in the Grand Prix so far.
Yeah, what a night for the Aussies. They've started in great style, and Batchelor hasn't had the best of seasons this year. He's had all sorts of injury troubles, and seems to have put them behind him here this evening, and is riding very nicely indeed, and has come up with two clinical wins. Plenty of speed. Janowski rides a nice ride in second place. He's had a steady night so far. He's got 4 points to his name with two second places. But it's that man, Batchelor, from the outside, a long way from there. The bike really does dig in and drive hard to that first corner. He'll be really pleased with that. Kilderman around the outside, can't land a blow. It's just hasn't quite got enough speed to really get at the front two, and Harris unfortunately gets tailed off out the back, but Troy Batchelor and Yanofsky pull away, but it's the Australian out in front. Gotta say, tremendous credit to him. Hasn't had a great season so far. This is probably his best Grand Prix comfortably this season.
Well, Batchelor and Doyle will now meet in Heat 9, two unbeaten riders. Batchelor and Doyle will be together. Batchelor now on 23 Grand Prix points, rocketing up the standings. He's gone well ahead of Chris Harris now, and just edging up the standings. It's all about getting in that top eight, remember. And interestingly, what will they do about the wild cards next year? Four wild cards. Yarra Campbell's got to be in contention. Darcy Ward is back on a speedway bike now as well. It'll be interesting. That's a chat for another day. Let's focus on this. Heat 7.
Okay.
Woffenden, inside gate.
Yeah, and he'll be hoping for more from his bike this time. He sat still in his opening ride when he spun up. Yeah, we'll get to that next week, shall we?
Okay.
But no, right now we'll talk about the championship leader.
We might have
leader.
A bit of time to fill later on. We can talk about it.
Okay,
then.
Yeah, we'll see how it goes. Okay, yeah. No worries.
You fetch a coffee and we'll just talk about
it. Fine, absolutely. Woffenden on the inside, meanwhile, he'll be looking to get away a little bit better than he did first time.
Well, indeed, Heat 7, Woffenden off the inside. Kasperzak, then it's Jonasson, then it is Zegar. Here we go. Heat number 7, the world championship leader, Woffenden, is off the inside gate. He's made a better start this time. He looks across as well. He does that a lot these days, Ty Woffenden. He studies the way the race is, and he's looking over his shoulder. Jonasson is coming on strong here and having a go, but Woffenden has the lead. Jonasson is second. Third now coming through in blue is Christoph Kasperzak, and Matti Zegar, he's returned the compliment and come through into third place. But Woffenden, with a good start from gate one, he's got it right this time.
Yeah, and I spoke about it earlier about how in tune he is with his equipment, and quite clearly he knows exactly what to do when the bike spins up at the start or dies off the corner, and it looks very impressive out in front, very fast indeed. Thomas H. Jonasson, who had that nasty injury, knee injury that he sustained in Tampere, is riding nicely in second place. Zegar there had a bit of a dust up with Kasperzak on the opening lap, but he's made that third place here, and the woes continue for KK, but the world championship leader out in front, and he's comfortable.
Well, he spent the last couple of weeks off away from the bike doing a lot of DIY on his new house in Staffordshire in the UK, and is certainly doing the business here in Heat number 7 in Latvia.
Oh.
And now a battle for second as Zegar really pushed hard on Thomas H. Jonasson. Don't quite think he got there though, but Woffenden, what a ride, looking so relaxed. And moves on to 5 points from two rides.
Yeah, an exhibition ride, really. Tight between Jonasson and Zegar. Jonasson just hanging on for second place. A good battle between those two. But as I said, an exhibition from Ty Woffenden, the championship leader, former world champion. And the bike dug in and drove hard to the first corner this time and made no mistake at all. And heat number 7 was all about Woffenden. Very impressive in front.
Woffenden, Jonasson, Zegar, Kasperzak. Now we have Batchelor and Doyle on 6, Woffenden on 5, and all three will meet in Heat 9, by the way. What a lineup that is. Woffenden will have the outside gate in Heat 9.
Yeah, we see it again. He's on the inside. He's parked up fairly close to Gate 2, and the bike really does charge to the first corner nicely. He has a good look over his right shoulder. Again now, coming off the corner, he knows he's got racing room. He can sweep up towards the safe defence as he goes down the back straight. Look. Very, very aware of what's going on around him. Seems to have so much time. He's super relaxed, super confident. And having a little look at Thomas H. Jonasson as I go down the back straight. Kasperzak is forceful early on, but it's a desperate move in reality. Zegar then repays the compliment and slips back into third place. But this is the style of the man that is comfortably out in front in the World Championship. Two big weeks of speedway, of course. He's fresh, coming here off the back of a bit of painting and decorating. And I'll tell you what, he looks absolutely fired up and raring to go.
60 points in the championship now for Ty Woffenden, 47 for Pedersen. Woffenden is now 13 clear in the championship. As we build up to heat number 8 after this race, every rider will have had two outings here in Daugavpils tonight. It's very fast, it's a super quick racetrack. And a chance for these riders to get some points on the board because two of them have yet to score. Michael Jepsen-Jensen is one of them off the inside. Andreas Jonsson, 2 points for him so far. Kaspod Zooks, the wild card off 3. And Niels Christian Iversen going off the outside.
Yeah, Iversen made the start initially in his opening ride, but then got passed. But still, nonetheless, it was a solid start for him. Akel Jebsen-Jensen's a little bit of an enigma, you know. A Grand Prix winner, a World Cup winner a couple of years back, but subsequently has suffered some injury problems. His father's been was ill for a period of time and hasn't quite recaptured that level of performance. Jonsson, who won the World Cup, of course, with Sweden, a desperate Cardiff, needs to really build here this evening.
Well, that was a real quick start from Podzuks off gate number three, but Jebsen-Jensen is there now. Jonsson tries the inside line. The red lights are on. I'm not really too surprised about that. It looked to me as though Podzuks did drop the clutch way too early there without touching the tapes. But once again, Marek Wojciech calling the race back. And here we see it.
Yeah, fraction early. Fraction early.
Well, if it's team racing and you're team manager of Podzuks, how do you feel there?
Well, you're a bit
aggrieved. The referee,
You're not a fan, no, not at all. It doesn't get to the front, though, and possibly the race could have been allowed to continue, but it wasn't. The two-minute clock is on immediately, so the riders won't be too far away from going back to the tapes. Track's actually riding slicker than I thought it was going to be. Quite clearly, the warm sunshine that we had earlier here this afternoon has dried the track out, Nige, and it is a little bit tough to find an extra bit of grip to pass people.
Yep.
Kats Podzuks, in actual fact, we're looking at him there. He had a great meeting last year, didn't he, when he came at the 11th hour for Darcy Ward. And this man, sometimes it's difficult to work out, Jonsson, you know. He rides so fast and can be a Grand Prix winner. He really can be spectacular. And then in Cardiff, he only got a couple of points and looks like he's not settled at the moment. He's had a massive change of equipment once again on the engine front. And just at times, when he gets it right, he can be so fast and so good.
We remind you that this Grand Prix last year, the story with Darcy Ward, with the reason that Podzuks came in last year, Ward failed an alcohol test here in Latvia last year, has served a 10-month ban, has made a comeback by scoring, 26 points for Swindon in the British Elite League.
Not too bad.
Has now signed for Zielona Góra in the Polish League and would dearly, dearly love the opportunity to be back in the Grand Prix next year. Whether that proves to be the case remains to be seen. He's got to get through this second half of the season to continue his rehabilitation, I guess. But there's no doubt on the speedway bike, he's a terrific talent. Here we go with heat number eight. Michael Jebsen-Jensen off the inside. Andreas Jonsson off two. Kats Podzuks off three. And Niels Christian Iversen going off the outside in yellow. Second time of asking. And in eight heats, three of them have been called back now.
Yeah, and unsatisfactory start. Riders very keen to get to the first corner. It's slicker than I anticipated. And that's putting extra pressure on riders to try and stamp their authority on races really early.
And the tapes go up a lot quicker this time. Jebsen-Jensen with the lead early on. Now what can Iversen do around the outside in yellow? He's got lots of speed, but Jebsen-Jensen holds the line. Now Niels Christian Iversen, the star of Cardiff, goes high and wide into the dirt in turns three and four. He's going to try the switch back up the inside. Almost cuts the nose off Andreas Jonsson. Podzuks is trying to come through now. And Jebsen-Jensen holds the lead. Iversen, though, looks quicker. Iversen looks quicker than his fellow countrymen, but Jebsen-Jensen hangs on.
Yeah, good opening lap from Jebsen-Jensen. Got to say, Iversen all action. Very close between Jonsson and Iversen. Jonsson now coming through into second place. Good ride there from the Swedish rider. Runs wide. Iversen then replays the compliment handlebar to handlebar. Really battling hard down the back straight. That gives Jebsen-Jensen just a little bit more breathing space. Jonsson around the outside. Iversen up the inside. It's really tight for second and third. But the young Danish rider responding well here. He needs this.
Certainly does. Jebsen-Jensen with a terrific ride. And now Jonsson's going to have one last go on Niels Christian Iversen. Great speedway for second spot here. Jebsen-Jensen is going to take the checkered flag. A quick look over his shoulder. Iversen hangs on for second under pressure from Jonsson. And that was more good speedway here in Daugavpils in Latvia tonight with Kats Podzuks trailing at the back. But good speedway. Jebsen-Jensen missed all the action.
He did, yeah. He really should have had eyes in the back of his head there, shouldn't he? Because he would have been royally entertained. Because the two boys behind him, Jonsson and Iversen, were swapping places nearly every corner. But, yeah, good ride from Jebsen-Jensen. As I say, at times he can go missing in a meeting, but he didn't that time. That was a really impressive 3 points for him.
So far then, after eight heats, Batchelor and Doyle lead on six, and Woffenden gets a point advantage over Pedersen and leads the World Championship by 13 points now.
Yeah, good ride that for Michael Jepsen Jensen. He'll be pleased with that because he failed to score in his opening ride. Tapes went up really quickly that time, and that's frustrating. Riders having to wait a bit, and then that went up very quickly. But Jepsen Jensen was sharp away from the tapes. And a real good battle between Iversen and Jonsson here. They really did throw everything at each other, didn't they? But the man on the inside, Jepsen Jensen, is superb. And then it's a great ride. It's possibly the best action we've seen so far between riders, with Andreas Jonsson and Niels Christian Iversen. I thought Iversen might just have enough speed to get the better of the Danish rider out in front, but can't do anything. Very tight there, wasn't it, between Jonsson and Iversen at the end of the first lap. Very nearly running in the side of Iversen Jonsson there with Podsuks out the back, but here we see Jonsson up the inside. Good speedway, good battling, good stuff.
Yeah, good ride from Jepsen Jensen, as you said, Kelv. He needed that. It was a good race because he was under pressure. Now, Matse Janowski is our guest with Steve Brandon.
Matse Janowski, a very solid start with 2 second places tonight.
Yeah, no, looks like second position is my favorite after last 2 weeks. So, I try my best. It's maybe not really good, but I have 4 points so far, so it's one of the best my score. So I'm I try win something because I need this.
I know you've ridden here in junior speedway, but your first chance in a Grand Prix. How is the track for you tonight?
Track is smooth like a table, so I'm it's easy to race, but it's pretty tricky for the setup, and we all the time look for the grading and how much water they put. So I hope we don't miss this.
And a few nerves at the start in your second ride?
I try to be quicker than the referee, so I must be careful.
He caught you out. And just in case people don't know at home, Polish final recently, you won your first Polish championship, so congratulations. But 6 second places and you won the race that mattered. That would do you tonight.
Yeah, that's why I say second place is my favorite last time. But hope so.
Fingers crossed. Thanks for your time.
Yeah, steady start for the evening for Janowski, 2 second places, and plenty to build on for him. Kasperzak there just in the foreground, he's having a difficult time. That's Nicky Pedersen's bike. They're just working on the clutch, making sure that that's absolutely A1 for his third ride.
And Michael Jepsen Jensen is now our guest in the pits with Steve Brandon.
Michael, great way to bounce back in your second ride.
Yeah, it was way better. The first one, I didn't really have any speed, you know. I think the track is a bit heavier today than the practice yesterday. But I didn't really see that for the track walk. So we did a bit extra power in the bike and was working really nice. From the start, everything was just working me. The first one, I couldn't really do anything. I was just spinning around, dying and these things. So it was way better.
People would have noticed this afternoon, very bright, very sunny, very hot, and the temperature has dropped. I mean, how much does that? You have to really be sensible with setup.
The setup is more similar now, like for just 8 heats ago, you know, compared to the practice yesterday. So it's way better. But yeah, we got to change a few bits and bobs, but it's working now.
A long way to go this season, 8 rounds including tonight for you. Just about building momentum now?
Yeah, I just need more points, you know. I haven't been really satisfied in my last few meetings. I need a few extra points. I don't want to be the last guy in the semis. I want to get up there, you know, and be safe.
3 more races to heat 20. You'll say 5 more heats tonight. Good luck.
Thank you, Mike.
Yeah, it was a good ride, and he's got a great command of the English language. I know they learn English at school. Bits
great,
and bobs
great.
Stood out for me there.
Yeah, I'm loving that. And as you rightly say, he's totally fluent in the language, has a very good understanding of it, and he has a very good understanding of riding a motorbike on a speedway track because he was impressive last time and had some decent speed. Scored 8 points. Last time in Cardiff, so he's looking to improve upon that. And of course he was a permanent wild card, so he'll be looking to try and make sure that he gets well ensconced in the top eight so he doesn't have to rely on that again.
Well, before tonight he was actually in ninth place, Michael Jeppsen Jensen, so 27 points before this evening puts him on to 30 now. Jason Doyle has moved on to 35, so he's a real mover and shaker.
He is indeed, and so is Troy Batchelor. And it's a very interesting lineup for heat number nine with Ty Woofenden also in the race, who was very impressive last time.
Yep, very much so. Chris Holder on 34 as well. But there's some in-form riders tonight, including this man, Jason Doyle, with Steve Brandon.
Jason, a quick word before you go out in heat nine. Perfect start for you tonight.
Yeah, that's it. Just making some good starts at the moment. The tracks are coming to racing now, so hopefully I can adapt to it.
And I know people at home in Australia watching, getting out of bed. Mum's told you to smile more. She'll be smiling now.
Yeah, that's it. Mum's in England at the moment, so say hello to me mum and then my girlfriend and fiance. Sorry, back at home, so we'll be right.
Wow, girlfriend and fiance. He's doing well there.
I tell you what, he's rewritten a rule book there, hasn't he? Because if he's pulling that off, fair play to him.
He's not got a wife as well, has he?
You never know. But this is a terrific lineup. We see the championship standings. Of course, Ty Woofenden now. 13-point lead in the championship. He'll be pleased with that. And he's up now. He's coming out against the two Australians that are unbeaten so far. And with Niels Christian Iversen thrown in for good measure, this is an excellent looking heat number nine, Nigel.
Yes, fantastic. And if Woofenden's going to get there, he's really got to get there from gate four and with one of the better starts of his career.
Yes.
But Batchelor on gate one, Doyle off gate three, the two unbeaten riders, and Iversen in the thick of the action as well. He's on 4 points, so this is a massive heat number nine coming up. And it's a good Grand Prix so far, Kel.
Yeah, it's building up nicely, and riders are beginning to figure out the track. Jeppsen Jensen, of course, was saying his setup now has improved. Woofenden certainly looked much more impressive last time. Heat number nine coming up. Super stuff.
Yes, what a lineup this is for heat number nine. Troy Batchelor, maximum man so far off the inside. Niels Christian Iversen of Denmark, gate two in blue. Jason Doyle, also a maximum man, gate three in white. And Ty Woofenden off the outside in yellow. This is a big race then, heat number nine, and a good Grand Prix so far with plenty of exciting action on this Dowager Pills track.
Yeah, it's building up nicely, and it's a terrific lineup with riders in really good form. Doyle and Batchelor have been outstanding so far with two race wins to each of them. Woofenden was hugely impressive last time out with a comfortable win, and the bike rocketed away from the inside gate. And Iversen, of course, he knows what it's about. Got a lot of character, that man, and he'll be battling really hard. So, yeah, this is a really mouth-watering heat in prospect. Can the World Championship leader get the better of the two unbeaten Australians?
It is a tall order from gate number four, but we saw it with Batchelor in heat number six.
Yep.
Can this man do it from the inside this time? Batch, who is having a terrific night so far. Will it be a Batch attack from Troy Batchelor? Heat number nine it is, and they're away this time. The tapes went up pretty quickly there. Batchelor's made a good one. Woofenden with a switch up the inside now. Batchelor has the lead, and now Woofenden is trying to come up the inside, but Iversen's got loads of speed, and Doyle is at the back now. Woofenden will hold the inside line and almost loses it, and now Iversen coming around the outside of Batchelor, but Batchelor holds the line. Great speedway here in Dowager Pills tonight.
Fabulous stuff from Batchelor. Woofenden very nearly turned the bike inside out. They've watered the track, and he's gone right to the back. Very greasy there, and Doyle has got into third place, and Woofenden, who looked so impressive last time out, is out the back. Batchelor looking like he's going to just about hang on as they go into the next lap. Thought he might just come under a bit more pressure from Iversen, who's really threatening in second place, but Batchelor having a fabulous night at Speedway.
Yeah, super ride from Troy Batchelor of Australia on his way to a third successive win with Iversen second, and Doyle is packing up just as he goes over the line here. Is that four laps?
No. Doyle's packed up.
I saw Doyle slowing up there, and I just thought, hang on a minute. But Doyle has got a puncture now, it seems. Batchelor, Iversen, Woofenden, and it appears that Doyle has now got a puncture, just as Hancock did. My goodness, I saw Doyle slowing up over the line there. Thought it was the end of the race. But anyway, he's pulled up with a puncture again.
Yeah.
and Batchelor get three rides and three wins.
Yeah, fabulous night for Troy Batchelor and an excellent ride there. Such a competitive race. Woofenden was dead and buried, inherits third place. A bit of good fortune for him with all the puncher from Jason Doyle. But I've got to say, Troy Batchelor coming back from injury, inspired so far tonight.
Where has this come from Batchelor? He is simply superb. 9 points out of nine. Doyle, Everson and Woofenden on 6 points apiece now. Doyle should have been on seven, but for the problem there in heat number nine, where, there you go, frustration. But Batchelor, a delighted man off the inside gate, 9 points out of nine.
Yeah, you can't do better than that. And he makes an excellent fist of it initially, a really good first corner. The track's gone quite greasy. They watered it and it's slick and it's just cooled off a bit. And I think it caught Woofenden out here. He doesn't get away so well from the outside. And Doyle there just being forced wide by Everson. It's a tough first corner as it always is. Woofenden makes that move to come through into second place momentarily and Everson on the outside. But Woofenden doesn't stay there very long because he then decides to run wide. He very nearly backs the bike in there and turns it inside out. Greasy, very greasy and a touch tricky. Very close between Everson and Batchelor here. Watch how tight this gets. Very close indeed between these two boys. Having a real good go.
Brilliant speedway.
Super action there, no question of that. Woofenden's out the back, but Doyle then runs into trouble. And Woofenden inherits a fortunate third place. But Troy Batchelor, he doesn't inherit anything. That was hard earned and fully deserves the 9 points.
Yeah, great effort from Troy Batchelor. 9 points out of nine. Here we go with heat number 10. Just remind me, speedway is over four laps.
It is normally, yep.
Yeah,
occasionally it can be over three. We've seen that before, but most of the time, I believe in the rule book, it is over four.
Cheers, mate. Kasper Podzuk's off the inside, the wild card. Greg Hancock goes off gate number two in blue. Christoph Kasperzak yet to score. What is going on with Kasperzak? And off the outside, the Polish champion, Matt Janowski. This is heat number 10.
Yeah, absolutely. And Hancock, who had a solid second place after the puncher in his opening ride, will be looking to build on that.
Takes rise, and it's a great start from Podzuk off the inside gate. Now Hancock gets the drop, and Janowski with a lovely switch up the inside. Now Hancock with the lead. Second place is Matt Janowski. Third is Kas Podzuk, and it's Christoph Kasperzak suffering a nightmare here in Daugavpils tonight, but Hancock looking good.
Yeah, Podzuk was the first man to drop the clutch, but I've got to say, Hancock's bike drove really nicely to the first corner. Janowski once again enjoying another second place. Podzuk is coming on strong in third. Got to keep your eyes on him. He's riding nicely. The world champion comfortable out in front. Kasperzak desperate. Really just does not look like he's got any confidence at all. He's tailed off. But this is encouraging for Hancock. A desperate start with the puncture. Looks like he's going to move on to 5 points and he'll be pleased with that.
Yeah, it'll be Greg's first win of the night. He has won here before, of course, in Daugavpils. He's got a love affair with this locomotive stadium track. Now Janowski has got some drive,
coming.
He's got some speed.
Whoa.
He's going to have a real go.
Done him.
Oh, Hancock is slowing up there, is he? Well, Janowski has got the lead.
Yeah, he's
and
got
Hancock
another puncture.
Is struggling. He's got a puncture.
Can you believe it?
And he's
the
held
last
up for
lap.
Second place.
Oh, he's very fortunate to pick up any points at all. Janowski was ready to pounce, made a great fist of it, but Greg Hancock, quite clearly something very wrong. Unusual to have two punches in a meeting. And as I say, he's just about got away with that, with picking up 2 points when he should have had three, but it could very easily have been none if it had happened a few moments earlier. So the world champion having no luck at all. Well, he is, in actual fact. He's having bad luck. And Janowski inherits a win. So, dramatic last lap.
I wonder how many times in Greg's 26-year professional career he's had two punctures in one meeting.
Well,
not very often.
No, not very often at all. Fortunately, he got 2 points out of it, though, didn't he, Nigel?
That's right. Janowski onto seven. Hancock onto four now. Podzuk gets off the mark with a single. And Kasperzak yet to trouble the scorers. More drama. Heat number 10. Janowski, the winner.
Yeah, he inherits the lead. He was riding nicely. Got to say, Podzuk drops the clutch first, but it's Hancock that gets to the first corner. Nice move to the inside from Janowski. And that's pretty much how it was, with Kasperzak once again struggling for speed. Just focusing in on the rear tire there. We've seen three punches tonight, two from that man. There you see it there, look, coming off the rim. And quite clearly, they haven't got enough air pressure in the tire. That's quite possibly. He has changed to the Mitas tyre this evening. Ordinarily, he used the golden tyre. And you just see the tyre coming off the rim there, losing pressure, and that pinches the tube, and all the air comes out of it. A blow for the world champion, but Janowski's well pleased. He inherits the lead. And 7 points out of three, that does very nicely.
Well, I did wonder, to be honest, where that speed came from Magic down the back straight. He looks so much quicker than Greg, and now we know why.
Yeah. And
you've got to feel sympathy for Greg Hancock. It's just not been his night tonight. Heat number 11 coming up, and we have Nicky Pedersen going off gate two here. The man in blue is second in the standings right now. And it's Andreas Johnsen off the inside. It's a big lineup here with Johnsen and Zagar and Harris really chasing points. All about getting 8 or 9 points for a place in the semi-finals here. Johnsen off the inside, Nicky Pedersen goes off two. Zagar goes off gate three in white, and Chris Harris is the man off the outside in yellow.
Well, all these riders are chasing points, aren't they? They need to really make a fist of it. Zagar on his night, of course, is devastating, and I would have thought this place would have suited him. Pedersen started nicely on a very strong opening ride, and Johnsen has been battling hard but hasn't quite managed to get to the first corner.
Yep, here we go then, and it's a super start from Pedersen off gate two. He's got the drop, brilliant from Nicky Pedersen. Now he's got the drive down the back straight as well. Johnsen has got to chase hard. Zagar's going to charge up the inside as well, but it's Johnsen who holds second spot. Nicky Pedersen is going to claw back points in the title race here, and Zagar comes through into second.
Yeah, good move from Zagar there, pouncing on Andreas Johnsen. Harris is out the back, Pedersen responding nicely. Good opening lap from him, a clean pair of heels to the opposition. Now Zagar in second place, Johnsen charging hard in third. Once again, just not getting away that well, but got plenty of speed once the race gets going. Harris is out the back, he's struggling here this evening, but Nicky Pedersen bouncing back well.
Yeah, Pedersen riding in all levels of the sport, riding well in all levels of the sport, big individual events, getting through the finals on a regular basis, and here he is with loads of speed. Nicky Pedersen, triple world champion, has that lead. Matty Zagar second, third in red is Andreas Johnsen, who really is putting pressure on Zagar, and Chris Harris adrift at the back, but Pedersen is going to move on to 7 points here in Daugavpils tonight from Zagar in second and Johnsen in third, and that's a big win for Nicky Pedersen to move on to 7 points here after three rides.
Yeah, super ride from Nicky Pedersen. He had to battle hard in his previous one, but you're right, two heat wins, and two heat wins are vital, particularly if it gets tight after five rides. They can come to your rescue if it's really nip and tuck as you go towards the semis.
Zagar holding on for second place there under serious pressure from Andreas Johnsen. Good speedway again, but Pedersen did it all from gate two. From the gate, 7 points, and looking good for a place in the semi-finals, but it's all about Batchelor so far, the only maximum man in the meeting.
Yeah, Pedersen is riding nicely. This is a good effort from him. Comes away from the tapes and makes that first corner him. Gate two working nicely. Johnson's there momentarily in second place, and Zagar comes charging down that back straight and roars underneath the Swedish rider, and the Slovenian then gets the better of Johnsen. And it's a good battle, actually, for second and third between Zagar and Johnsen. Not a good night for Harris. Once again, he's tailed off out the back, and he's only scored just the 1 point from his three outings so far, and he's destined not to make the semis tonight. But the man out in front, moving on to 7 points. Good speedway, that between Zagar and Johnsen. A real competitive battle for second and third. But Nicky Pedersen, well, I tell you what, he was impressive here, and he had a good speed in front.
And he had a lot of drive going into that first turn away from the start.
Important.
The bike dragged him forward magnificently. 7 points for Pedersen. No wonder he's a happy man as we build up to heat number 12. And Chris Holder needs points here off the inside gate. The race for the top eight is really taking shape in fascinating style.
It's tight, isn't it?
Very tight.
And you can ill afford to slip up. With two Grand Prix and consecutive weekends, it's so vital that you keep amongst the points on every possible occasion.
Yep, it's Holder off the inside then. Michael Jeppesen Jensen, gate two. Peter Killerman goes off gate number three. He's found it hard tonight. Peter Killerman in for the injured Jarek Campbell. And Thomas H. Jollison going off the outside in yellow. This is heat number 12.
I just wonder whether Kilderman would prefer a little bit more grip on the track, Nige. You know, he's a hard charger and he really runs in hard, and so far this evening, he's found it tough. Thomas H. Jonathan's crew there, he's done okay. He got second place last time, and Holder, of course, on the inside was very impressive in his opening ride, but found it difficult second time out. Jepsen Jensen, impressive second time out.
Yes, here we go, and Holder's made a good start from the inside here this time. It's a great start from Holder, and Jonasson goes square as Jepsen Jensen comes up the inside, and now Peter Kellerman charging around the outside. Lovely move from Peter Kellerman, who gets the better of his fellow Dane, Michael Jepsen Jensen, but Chris Holder is looking good here, has the lead. Second Kellerman, third Jepsen Jensen, Jonasson is in the back, but Chris Holder is in command here.
Yeah, and once again, when he hits the front, he's got a lot of speed. And he looks really impressive. They're chasing the dirt right out by the safety fence. Very spectacular indeed. Someone says Jonasson coming on strong in fourth place, trying to get the better of Jepsen Jensen. Kilderman got the better of Jepsen Jensen in the first corner. But look at Holder. Holder has tons of speed. And although he was disappointing in his second ride, when he hits the front, he's a tough man to peg back. Good stuff from Holder.
Yeah, this will really boost his season. This will put him onto 37 Grand Prix points, Chris Holder. And he's winning it quite comfortably here as well. He's clearly enjoying the conditions, reveling in the situation here. Big win, Chris Holder. 6 points out of a possible nine. Second place there goes to Peter Kellerman with Michael Jepsen Jensen in third, who moves on to 4 points tonight. Tough for Thomas H. Jonasson. That was a mighty fine ride from Chris Holder, the 2012 world champion. And after 12 heats, that doubles his score to six. Much
yeah,
needed.
Absolutely. And I say it again, heat wins are really crucial when it comes towards the semi-final. If you're on about 8 or 9 points, it really can come to your rescue.
Holder, Kellerman, Jepsen Jensen. And after 12 heats here in Daugavpils, Latvia tonight, we have Troy Batchelor leading the meeting on 7, on 9 even. Pedersen and Janowski on 7. Holder, Doyle, Woffenden and Everson have 6 points each.
Yeah, well, Batchelor's having a great night, and to all intents and purposes, Chris Holder is. And as I say, when he hits the front, he's hugely impressive, and the motorbike is really fast. And he makes a good fist of it from the inside, allows the bike to sweep up to the banking, and he's away. And really, he has no real threat. It's Peter Kilderman who makes the best of it into second place, gets the better of Jepsen Jensen as they go down the back straight. Bit of battling early on between the two Danish boys, but I've got to say that Holder, once he's hit the front, he looks really impressive. Bit of battling between Thomas H. Jonasson and Jepsen Jensen for the third place, but no, Chris Holder pleased with that after the disappointment of failing to score last time out. And the former world champion looking like a champion that time.
Holder 6 points. Two wins from his three rides. And as Kelvin mentioned, if it does go to count back, race wins vital for a place in the semi-final. But we've seen some good racing. We know it's fast. We know it's exciting. And we could be in for a terrific second half of the meeting here in Latvia tonight. There's the track work going on where they're pulling the dirt back, and they'll just give it a good watering as well. And yeah, it's good to see. I'm sure that was Chris Holder's dad that we saw there.
Absolutely, and I think it's great credit to Batchelor that he's gone through the card so far, because everybody else is dropping points. And Batchelor has been able to get a really good run to the first corner, and the bike's working nicely. And once you get away, it does appear to be, you know, you can then really dominate the races.
Well, Niels Christian Everson now is talking to our man, Steve Brandon.
Niels, three heats gone, two to go, but six solid points for you.
Yeah, it's been all right so far. I just need a little bit extra to get the heat wins, but yeah, hopefully it'll come now.
Tracks change a lot during a whole meeting, but they look like they're changing quite a lot during each bracket of four heats.
Last time I was out just after track service, and it was obviously a little bit wet and slippery, and it was a little bit different from the races before, but yeah, we just got a roll with the track, and hopefully we'll sort it out.
Back in the right part of the score chart championship wise now, just about building momentum again?
Yeah, you know, it's still such a long way to go, but yeah, points are there for taking, so I might as well take them.
I'll let you take a breath, get back to work, thanks.
Well, solid stuff from Everson, isn't it? You know, 3 second places, and quite clearly just needs to find a little bit more to the first corner, and I'm sure he'll probably win a couple of races, but he's well on course for a semi-final spot. But they will have to keep an eye on track conditions when they do the track grading, because no question it caught Ty Woffenden out. interesting to see if we find out about that, but it was greasy after the previous track grading. And one or two riders just finding it difficult to get the same grip out of the bike as they had previously.
Very much so. Good crowd here in Daugavpils tonight. They do love their speedway here. The league racing, they're actually in the Polish league, Daugavpils, but they do get big crowds for their league racing here as well. And really is a very passionate crowd. Now, Chris Holder, let's hear his thoughts on 6 points out of nine with Steve Brandon.
Chris, two great race wins and one heat. Looked like the track caught you out.
Yeah, you could say that. The second one, I didn't make a great start, but I thought I could just squeeze in there to the corner. But sort of got stuck in that gutter of inside and bombed the first corner. And then Nicky come through, and then I just ate a lot of dirt from then on.
The very positive thing, though, is the two heats you've won, you look like you've got some speed to burn.
Yeah, I feel good. Like, even the second race, we didn't change a thing from that one to just then. So I just knew I made a bit of a mistake in the first corner, and after the grading, it's near impossible to do anything. It's like ice and throwing a whole lot of mud. It's difficult, but yeah, made a better start then and just want to make the most of the next two.
When you come away from Cardiff Grand Prix, I know we're sort of three heats into this one, but how much can you take from the fact you're right in the mix and you do very well in a meeting?
Yeah, well, I haven't been in the mix in the meeting for a little while. I've had a couple of good races here and there, but never really stayed up there. So to run, you know, top scorer and get second was a bit of a boost for us. I really needed it. I've been battling, like I said before, on and off, but hopefully I can do something tonight.
Two to go. Keep up the work.
Thanks, man.
Kelvin, are they doing a lap too much watering, do you think, for the guys that are coming out immediately after the grading break?
It will catch them out, possibly, because there's a lot of water going on. And Phil Morris, of course, the race director, has stood on the centre green, but it was very tricky after the race preparation, track preparation last time.
Well, Greg Hancock is with us. Don't let him touch the microphone. It might get a puncture. He's with Steve Brandon.
Greg, you and I go right back in this series. I don't think I ever remember a night where a rider's had two punctures in one meeting.
No, and I probably have been one of those guys who's never had two in one meeting either. But, we're doing so much testing and so much playing right now, and maybe we went a little too far tonight.
A little bit on that, though. Your experience and ability to get through the last part of a race and still pick up 2 points is very impressive.
Yeah, you know, we got to keep rolling with it. And I think just for a little bit too low air pressure now, we'll get things back to normal. But, you know, I'm always chasing something more, and it's never good enough.
Never stop experimenting. But now you kind of know now you have to dig in and get two really good race results.
Yeah, that's right. Points are everything right now, and I can't afford to let anything go. So game on.
You guys looking at the championship, looking at the standings, Ty sort of having a quiet night. It's a chance to capitalize if you can get some points.
Yeah, I mean, it's still a long season to go, but any chance you can take those points, you got to take them. And, the kid's good and everybody here is good too. So it's a lot of mixing up tonight.
Thanks for your time.
Got it.
Well, it has to be said, Kelvin, credit to you. You did say it was an air pressure issue.
Yeah, he's been experimenting with the Mitas, and quite possibly he's become accustomed to running a lower tire pressure with the golden tire, which has got a stiffer sidewall. And they may well have found that in practice yesterday that really did feel very encouraging, but over four laps in the heat of battle, unfortunately, not quite enough air pressure in the tire to keep it stable enough, and it's just being pulled off the rim. And they're going to have to go up a pound or two to make sure it stays up, because it's all very well being out in front. But if you're going to win races, you've got to finish races. So he's now under pressure. Riders just preparing themselves now, of course, for Heat 13. Chris Harris is out. Jason Doyle is out here. And I've got to say, Doyle has had a really good night of speedway so far. And he's battling hard like Troy Batchelor. He's looking hard towards the semi-finals.
Heat 13 coming up then. The track rating is all but done. And sure, the 2 minutes time allowance is on. It is indeed. There's 30 seconds of the 2 minutes gone already, so the riders will be making their way out there. But the conditions have changed here for these riders. You have to have sympathy for the boys coming out immediately after a track grade, because it is a completely different track. And Jason Doyle then going off the outside here, looking to bounce back after his disappointment in his last outing. Here we go, heat number 13. It's going to be a terrific second part of the meeting, you feel. Heat number 13 is coming up here. Here we go, Heat 13. Thomas H. Jonasson off the inside with Kas Podzuks going off gate number 2 in blue. Chris Harris, gate 3 in white. And Jason Doyle, who had that puncture last time out, he's off the outside in the yellow helmet colour. Track conditions will have changed, of course. It'll be interesting to see how the riders adapt to this with a major track grade there just gone on.
Yeah, and plenty of water's gone on as well, and quite possibly the middle of the track will be very greasy indeed. So a choice has got to be made, either to really go very tight on the first corner or to allow the bike to maybe go around about three-quarter track to try and generate plenty of speed.
Nice of Troy Batchelor to get a feed of our commentary into his headphones in the pits.
Yeah.
I don't think so somehow, do you?
No. No, I don't think he is. But nonetheless, whatever it is, it's doing the trick because he's unbeaten so far. Doyle on the outside will be looking for more here. He was in the points last time, but the puncher stole those points off him.
Here we go. Heat number 13 then. Green light is on, and we're away first time of asking here. It's a good start from Jonasson off the inside, and Harris tries the inside switch. Doyle is there around the outside. Oh, how on earth did this stay on the bike? I thought that was going to end in tears. Harris has the lead here. Magnificent from the British boy, Chris Harris. Now Jason Doyle is going to put him under all sorts of pressure going into lap number two. And third in blue is Kas Podzuks of Latvia. I thought that was going to end in tears at one stage, but Chris Harris just picked them off, and he has the advantage.
Yeah, what a ride from Harris. He's done very little this evening, but he made a really good move in the first corner, and it's paid massive dividends. Got himself to the front, and he looks like he's holding station there. Doyle's coming on strong in second place, but Harris has made that choice. He went to the inside, and it certainly paid dividends on the first three laps of this race. Doyle is a massive threat in second place. No question, Doyle, the Australian, coming on really strong.
Yep, this is like a local derby in the UK with a Coventry man against a Leicester man, and here comes Doyle!
Oh!
Oh, into the fence, Harris goes! Doyle charged up the inside, there are no red lights on, the race has now been completed, and we await the declaration of the results.
Well, Doyle dive-bombed in Cardiff and got excluded, and I just wonder whether he's made the same mistake, because it was very close going down the back straight, and Doyle, of course, was had a lot of speed. He was coming on really strong as they went into the last lap. Harris made the commitment to ride to the inside, switches to the inside now, lets the bike run in there. Harris coming back across.
Oh.
There's a little bit of contact there, unsettles him. I fear for Doyle here.
Bang, out, got to go.
Yeah, that's unfortunate for Jason Doyle, because second place would have put him onto 8 points, and 8 points is often enough to make the semi-finals. And wow.
Doyle looked over his shoulder.
Oh, he does.
Doyle's gone, confirmation. Jason Doyle, there's the yellow light going on right now. So it's a win for Chris Harris, second place Podzuks, third Jonasson.
Have they declared the result, Nige?
Yes. The race was completed, and the race, therefore, result stands as Chris Harris, Kas Podzuks, Thomas H. Jonasson, and Jason Doyle disqualified. So from all of a sudden having 6 from 2, Doyle could have been on 8 from 4.
Mm.
He's now facing a real battle in his last race to reach the semi-finals. It's all going wrong for Jason Doyle, but for Chris Harris, a confidence-boosting win there.
Yeah, and a great first corner from Harris. He didn't get away too well, but Doyle just a little bit impetuous once again. And you can ill afford to make these mistakes at this level. He was enjoying a good night. And second place would have been a good result for him with a ride to go, and he could have built on that. Now, all of a sudden, with 6 points from 4, he'll need a really big ride in his last heat to make the semi-final. So he'll have to just reflect on that and see if he can learn from it, because sometimes 2 points is better than none.
He's got gate one in heat 17, Jason Doyle. And from a man who was unbeaten in 2 on 6 points, he now needs a second or a win in heat 17, a win preferably, to get into the semi-finals. Extraordinary. Heat 14. And here's your lineup. Matt Sienowski off the inside in red. Chris Holder, gate 2 in blue. Andreas Jonsson, gate 3 in white. The leader, Ty Woffenden, outside in yellow. Interesting to note that Nicky Pedersen, second in the standings, has 2 inside gates in his last 2 outings. Woffenden is off the outside here, and he'll go off gate 3 in heat 20. So, a real test for Woffenden. He won't worry about that, will he, Kelvin? He's a pretty cool customer.
He seems extremely relaxed right now. He will need to do something here, but it's not the first race after the track preparation. So last time it appeared to catch him out and he struggled and he inherited that third place when Doyle packed up. So he was a little bit fortunate there, but still in a very commanding position in the championship. Nothing to panic about from his perspective.
Here we go, heat number 14 it is, and it's a great start from Matsianowski off the inside gate. Now Wolfenden is weighing up his options, and he's switched up the inside. But coming around now in white is Andreas Jonsson. Jonsson dives up the inside. Now the lead is with Matsianowski, super right from him. Janowski holds the line, and Holder's come through on Wolfenden. Oh my goodness, it's going wrong for Wolfenden. The lead is with Janowski. Second is Jonsson, and third is Holder with Wolfenden at the back.
Yeah, once again, Ty Wolfenden's just struggling with the bike setup. Looked like he was fairly comfortable there, but Holder there was able to get into third place. Great stuff for Janowski out in front. He inherited the win last time, but he's building on that. Away from the inside, looking good. Jonsson's now under pressure. Holder's got a lot of speed. Really threatening in third place. Jonsson running wide, just on the edge of the dirt. The Swedish rider hanging on in second place, but Magic Janowski looking like he's going to go back-to-back wins, and that'll really give him a very good chance. Well, he'll be comfortably into the semis.
Yeah, and an outside chance for Jonsson now. This will put him onto six. Wolfenden's going to have one last go, but Holder's going to hold on to third. But Janowski, a super ride, and Holder just can't land a blow for second as Jonsson holds on. But that was good speedway again. And now a real opportunity for Nicky Pedersen when he comes out in heat 16 to reduce the deficit for the world title to single figures. After going into this meeting 12 behind, is this the night where the world title race takes another dramatic twist? Here we go, heat 14. Janowski the winner, super ride from him. Second place then went to Andreas Jonsson of Sweden. Third, Chris Holder. And Ty Wolfenden now has 6 points and needs a second place, at least you feel, in his last to give him any chance of a semi-final spot.
Well, you have to ask the question whether the DIY work is not quite what you need to prepare yourself for a Grand Prix. Just needs to be a little bit, with the bike setup not quite right, and the greasy conditions have been catching him out. We see the start again, and Janowski from the inside. It's a super start from him. The Polish rider, of course, inherited the lead. Good move initially in the first corner by Wolfenden, but Jonsson then comes roaring down the back straight into second place, and Wolfenden just has to momentarily shut the throttle off. Holder there on the outside then has a switch to the inside as he goes through turns 3 and 4 and gets the better of the championship leader and switches into third place. Janowski out in front, he's comfortable. Holder's got a lot of speed once again. Great, the motorbike really is very fast this evening. Bit of battling for between Holder and Wolfenden, but Jonsson's the one that has to then ride a little defensive here because Chris Holder comes on really strong as the race comes to its conclusion. But Magic Janowski, that's good stuff. That's 10 points out of 12.
Brilliant.
Very good. Very good indeed.
Yeah, touch of magic from Matze tonight for sure as we build up to heat number 15. This is quite a lineup as well. It's a massive race for Greg Hancock, who's off the outside gate, the reigning champion, on only 4 points, not helped by 2 punctures tonight. And here we go. Niels Christian Iversen, 3 second places, is off the inside. Maddie Zagar goes off gate 2, Peter Killerman gate 3, and Greg Hancock going off the outside in yellow, super lineup.
Absolutely, and all four riders looking for points here, really needing points if they're going to make the semi-finals this evening. That's the two lads from Iversen's crew, and they'll be keeping an eye on their man who goes from the inside gate. The world champion, of course, going from the outside gate, and he needs to keep that tyre on the rim this time and keep the air in the tyre because he's had a disastrous night so far.
Here we go, and Iversen has made a good one from the inside gate now. Hancock is at the back right now. Is there any way through for Hancock?
Oh, brilliant!
What a move from Greg Hancock! He picked his moment beautifully there. Second place is Niels Christian Iversen. And Matti Zagar is the man in blue around the outside as Killerman comes through. But Kelvin, you have to take your hat off to a fantastic move from Greg Hancock.
Well, a fabulous move in the first corner. Didn't get away too well from the outside, but a great decision. And he fired himself to the front. The bike dug in and got himself there. Iversen's having a real good go in second place. Kilderman coming through in third to get the better of Zagar. And a bit of a battle now between the Danish boys. Down the back straight they go, going towards the last lap. Kilderman coming on really strong around the outside of Iversen. got to say, the world champions out in front. Everson hanging on for another second place.
Yep, that inside line, they are literally riding on concrete there, aren't they?
Yeah.
Hancock down the back straight with Everson second. Third is Kilderman. And Greg Hancock is now going to move on here to 7 points. And that gives him a real chance, with a good result in his last ride against Harris, Wolfenden and Jensen, of salvaging his night and making the semi-finals despite two punctures. That would be quite a story.
Yeah, absolutely. Brilliant stuff, and a great character shown by the world champion. Super first corner from him. And Everson solid in second place, but 7 points, that's a decent effort when you consider he failed to score a couple of times.
Yep, it gives him a real chance. Everson, another second place for him. So that moves him on to 8 points. So Everson's quite happy with that.
Yeah.
And Matty Zagar at the back there with Kilderman third. So Hancock gives himself an outside chance. All depends on his result in Heat 20.
Well, you've got to admire his tenacity, haven't you? It's been a difficult night for him. He doesn't get there. And the gap opens up and the bike just gets that little bit of drive when he needed it. And he is able to fire himself to the front as they exit the first corner on the opening lap. He's out the back here. There's a nice little gap there, and the bike really gets a nice bit of grip right at the vital moment, and he's able to hit the front. And although Everson tries hard in second place, he's the man on the inside there. This gap that opens up for the world champion is absolutely ideal. Just a touch of grip in the middle of the corner, and he's out in front. Good effort from Kilderman, who comes on strong and puts Everson under a lot of pressure as the race comes to its conclusion. A spectacular ride once again from Peter Kilderman, but he hasn't quite got the speed that we've seen in previous Grand Prix. But that man with a ride to go, you've got to believe he's going to make the semi-finals.
Yep, giving himself a great chance, Peter Kilderman. Well,
tough,
I think his reaction says it all. It's a tough night for him. And here we have Nicky Pedersen, who will be acutely aware that the championship leader, Ty Woffenden, ran a last in his previous outing.
Yeah.
And now, if Pedersen can win this race, the lead in the world championship will be down to single figures.
Well, that's quite a turnaround. And Ty Woffenden has struggled in his last couple of rides. And Nicky Pedersen winning races from the inside gate must have a good chance.
Well, it'll narrow it to 8 points, won't he, with a win here. Pedersen off the inside, Batchelor off two, Jeppsen Jensen off three, and Kasperzak off four. But significantly, Pedersen will go through to the semi-finals with a win here, and there's no guarantee that Woffenden will, and that gives Pedersen the opportunity of two more heats in the semis and the final. It's another dramatic twist. The halfway stage of the World Championship is next week in Melilla. Join us for that wherever you are in the world. It's going to be a great night in Sweden next Saturday night. Pedersen has made a beauty off the inside gate. Magnificent start. Now Batchelor tries the inside line. And now Pedersen is going to have to wind it all. Lovely move from Nicky Pedersen. Looks as though Batchelor had got the drive. But Pedersen was there magnificently. He's gone wide. He's got the race under control. And Jeppsen Jensen comes up the inside of Troy Batchelor now.
Yeah, really good speedway there. Initially away from the tapes, it's Nicky Pedersen. It was tough stuff. Got to save Troy Batchelor, was in second place, but all credit to Jeppsen Jensen. A nice ride from him to get into second place, and the Australian is in third. Kasper Zak, a desperate evening, is out the back, not really showing any form or any speed at all, but Pedersen looking for his third win on the night. He's looking good. Jeppsen Jensen pushing hard in second place. Pedersen won't be able to relax with Kasper Zak has pulled up out the back. A lap to go, Nigel. Jeppsen Jensen is a threat. He's a big threat in second place.
Yeah, he's having a real go here, Michael Jeppsen Jensen, but Nicky's got the speed down the straight, and Nicky Pedersen is going to go through to the semi-finals here. This is a big win. He goes into double figures, puts him onto 10 points level with Matsi and Ski. And the race for the world title is getting ever closer here in Latvia tonight. This is round five. There's seven rounds to go after tonight, of course. But Nicky Pedersen with a fantastic win. But Christoph Kasperzak, what on earth is happening with KK?
Don't
four
know.
Rides and not one single point. But huge credit this man, Nicky Pedersen. 10 big points for him.
Yeah, really classy ride from Pedersen. Gets the inside gate and comes away with a really good win. Moving sweetly into the semi-finals, heaping some pressure on the world championship leader, Woffenden.
Yep, it means now that there are three riders on 10 points. Nicky Pedersen, Mats Ionowski and Troy Batchelor. Woffenden just in the top eight, but needs a big result in Heat 20.
Well, Nicky Pedersen, you can never write him off, and he's enjoyed really good success here before, and once again tonight, apart from his second ride, he's had three wins, and he's under pressure here with Batchelor making a good move in the first corner, but Nicky Pedersen has the speed down the back straight. Again from the tapes. Good start initially. He then allows the bike to just come off the inside, and that opens the door. He's in no man's land there, but just recovers enough in time to get the better of the opposition as they go down the back straight. Crew, of course, delighted with it. They're enjoying a good night of speedway. Jepsen Jensen then gets the better of Batchelor, who comes into second place as they start the second lap. And all credit to Jepsen Jensen. He puts pressure on Pedersen out in front, and it was a good speedway race. But Nicky Pedersen must be, as you rightly say, Nigel, he is aware of the situation. And I've got to say, he's piling the pressure on Woofenden. Woofenden's got to come up with something special in Heat 20.
Yeah, it's going well for Pedersen. Three wins out of a possible four. He knows things are going his way tonight. He would love a fourth world title.
Cool, would he ever? And he's got the inside gate once again. And there you see, the lead is still decent for Woofenden. No panic stations, of course, but he won't want to give Nicky Pedersen any encouragement. But rain. Now that
this wasn't forecast, was it?
Now that's something that I wasn't expecting at all. And
it was forecast for 10 o'clock tonight. It's come early. Well.
Dear, oh dear, that will, particularly with these slick conditions, that will make it very greasy and very tricky indeed. And let's keep our fingers crossed that it isn't too much, because you just sense that this meeting is really beginning to build up. And in the context of the World Championship, with Pedersen going great guns and Woofenden just struggling a fraction, let's hope that the weather doesn't spoil it.
Yeah, absolutely. That's the direction where the rain is coming from. And if it is forecast to set in for the night, it won't take long for the track to deteriorate because of the lack of dirt on it, really, Kelvin. That is a major concern. Ty Woofenden now is with our man, Steve Brandon.
Ty, does this count as a tough night at the office?
Yeah, for sure. I struggled a little bit here last year. Just find it tough to get the right setup here. Had a race win, but we didn't change anything for the next race, but I was out straight after the track grade. So it's a funny place, this, but that's it.
I asked Niels Christian-Everson earlier about that sometimes a track can change a lot during a meeting, but it seems to change a lot during four heats here.
Yeah, it changes after one race. They water the track, and normally the second heat is pretty decent, and the first heat after track grade's really, really slippery and hard to ride. But no excuses, just having a tough night.
Gate 3 in heat 20, you know exactly what you need. It has to be 3 points.
Yeah, that's it. So starting to rain now, so it'll make it a bit more interesting.
All right, thanks for your time.
Yeah, it will make it a little bit more interesting because there isn't a lot of dirt on this track. And if it rains for a length of time, it's going to make it quite awkward. And we may have to have a little bit of a break while the weather moves through. Let's hope that it doesn't rain too long, because it will make it quite tricky indeed. Riders covering up, of course, and Ty Woofenden quite honest there in his response to the question. He does find it a little bit awkward. He didn't have a great meeting here last year. And
this rain's coming down heavily now, Kelv.
That's disappointing. That's really disappointing, because riders are preparing themselves for Heat 17, but I tell you what, very quickly the track's going to be a real challenge to race on.
Well, yeah, there's not a lot on the inside at all.
Nothing, there's nothing on it at all. So, as I say, it is raining reasonably hard now, and it won't. So riders are appearing on the track, and so it will be quite interesting to see how they cope with the rain. They're quite clearly they're prepared to continue on. So let's keep our fingers crossed that conditions are decent and that the Grand Prix doesn't suffer too much because of it.
Well, we've had 16 heats here, and so whatever happens, we do have a result tonight. But it is steady drizzle here in Latvia now, in Daugavpils, as we await the arrival of the riders for heat number 17. And Doyle, Jonsson and Kilderman all need a win here, you feel?
Yeah, Jason Doyle has unnecessarily put himself under pressure the move that he made in Cardiff was very similar to the one he's made here this evening, where he's just got a little bit overexcited, looked at a possible move which came too late, and has collected a rider and has got excluded for it. And that's a shame for him, because he would have been on 8 points coming into his last ride and almost certainly would have had an outstanding chance of the semi-finals. Now he's on six. Really, a heat win here will give him the very good chance of making the semi-finals, but there's no question he's put himself under some unnecessary pressure with that mistake he made in his previous ride.
Heat number 17 and the rain getting heavier here, I'm sorry to say. Jason Doyle off the inside, gate two in blue is Andreas Jonsson. Third in white, Christoph Kasperzak, who will be desperate to just get out of here, I think. Failed to score tonight. And off the outside in yellow is Peter Kellerman. So Doyle, Jonsson and Kellerman all need points here as the rain just gets heavier. That's a concern.
Well, this is really disappointing, and it is a concern because conditions will change very quickly on this slick surface. Doyle on the inside, very difficult to know what he's going to do. If he's clear, he's possibly going to try and charge right up the banking to see what happens.
Yep, here we go then, heat number 17. Kellerman is there with a good ride in yellow. Doyle is second right now. Third in blue is Andreas Jonsson. This would put Peter Kellerman onto 8 points. It had also put Jason Doyle onto 8 points as well. And Christoph Kasperzak has packed up already at the back. Jonsson is going to have a go, but conditions far from ideal with the rain pouring down here in Daugavpils now.
Yeah, well, all credit to Kellerman. And all credit to Jason Doyle. He's coming on strong in second place. Thought for a moment he might look to go up the inside, but thought better of it. He's moved to the outside, and the outside has got a lot of speed, and he's coming on strong. Jonsson back in third place. Peter Kellerman needs this heat win. He's had a tough night, and a heat win here, who knows? He might have an outside chance of the semi-finals. Doyle now second, settling in second place, but he's got two wins to his name, but it's tight. There's a lap to go. Can Doyle do anything about it?
Well, super ride from Peter Kellerman. Track doesn't look too bad at the moment.
No.
But they're going to have to rush through another three heats after this to get us through to heat 20.
Definitely.
Then maybe take another look before the semi-finals, because the way the rain's coming down, you can't see them going much further than heat number 20. If things are as they are right now, it's Peter Kellerman, the race winner. Second place in red was Jason Doyle, who moves on to 8 points. And third in blue, Andreas Jonsson, who finishes the night on 7 points tonight. But Jason Doyle, big second place for him. But what about Peter Kellerman? He's turned his night around with that big race win. I put him on to 8 points tonight now. Second place Doyle, third was Jonsson. And Christoph Kasperzak pulled up in the first lap and has failed to score in tonight's Grand Prix. Kellerman and Doyle on to 8 points each.
Yeah, but interestingly, Doyle's got two heat wins. And if it goes to count bad, of course, that will count in his favour. Kasperzak will want to get in the van and get home as soon as possible. He has failed to score from his evening's work. What a start it was from the outside from Peter Kellerman. A great effort from him. Andreas Jonsson on the inside. You can see the rain there falling quite heavily. Racing conditions in heat 17 were reasonable in actual fact.
Yes.
Better than I expected, but the rain is continuing and it will make effect in the relatively near future. Good effort from Kellerman out in front. Doyle came on strong. I thought for a moment or two that Doyle might find a way through, but he can't quite do that. And Jason Doyle, who unfortunately got excluded in his previous race, comes close to Peter Kellerman, but can't find a way through. And Jonsson finishes on seven. He won't make the semi-finals. But that man who moves on to 8 points with a heat victory in his fifth ride, who knows, he may well do just.
Well, great ride from Peter Kellerman. As we say, five Grand Prix before tonight, and he's got through to the final in three of them.
Yeah.
As we say, big concern is the rain right now. Track conditions, as Kelvin said, were okay in heat 17, but could really do with getting these next three races done in super quick time to get us through to heat 20 and then maybe take another view of it. That's my opinion, of course. I'm not in no way an official of the meeting. I'm just saying.
Well, of course, Phil Morris, the race director, will have a lot to say about it. His judgment, of course. Riders, again, riding in the rain is about visibility, Nigel. It's about the rain on your goggles. And if you get a lot of spray coming off the surface, you can't see where you're going. And that is the major obstacle to overcome.
Pedersen, Janowski, Jonsson and Iversen then. Pedersen and Janowski level on 10 points apiece here on the night. Jonsson on 4 and Niels Christian Iversen on 8 points. So here we go.
Well, we just saw Phil Morris there having a look at the sky, and it's pretty black. In actual fact, it looks solid all the way around us, so I don't quite know how long it's going to be set in for, but Pedersen on the inside, he won't want the meeting to stop right now. He's on a roll. He's got the inside gate, and that's an opportunity for him to really put some more pressure on Ty Woofenden. It's been working out for Nicky Pedersen this evening. They settle down, heat 18 about to come on.
Here we go then. Pedersen's made a good one off the inside gate once again. Janowski is going to try the inside switch. A clever move from Matsi Janowski. Now can he block the drive of Pedersen, and Jonasson's come through. Nicky Pedersen has to get off the gas there. It's Jonasson, a shock leader here. Pedersen holds second place right now with conditions deteriorating with every lap. Jonasson has the lead. Pedersen is second. Matsi Janowski is third. Iversen's at the back, and it's getting all very close in the rain.
Yeah, and it's very greasy as well. Riders almost backing it in as they come in the corner. Thomas H. Jonasson just got the bite to come off the corner. It's very, very tight between Janowski and Nicky Pedersen. Pedersen now coming on hard in second place, running a little bit wide behind Thomas H. Jonasson. Janowski squaring the corner off. They're pulling the roll off. So tearing the tear-offs off as they come roaring down the back straight midway through the race in the pouring rain. Thomas H. Jonasson and Janowski. Brilliant ride from the Polish rider.
Well, Janowski has second place. It's a real challenge because Iversen has pulled up, clearly struggling to see now. Pedersen tries the inside line, has to get off the gas. Pedersen's going to have to settle for third here, but quite clearly now conditions are deteriorating, and if this rain stays in it as it is, well, it has to be questionable whether we will see any semi-finals and final tonight, or whether we'll just get through to heat 20.
What an effort from the riders, Nigel, in difficult conditions. Great racing, particularly from Thomas H. Jonasson on the move from the first corner to get himself to the front. Magic Janowski then comes up with a smashing ride to get the better of Nicky Pedersen. Good speedway.
Yeah, good speedway indeed in difficult conditions, because for me, Kelvin, the track was visibly worse there than it was in heat 17.
Agreed.
And if they are getting on with it, well, they've put the 2 minutes on straight away, by the way, for heat number 19. So the 2 minutes is on. But Jonasson, super ride from him. And credit to the other three guys as well. They really got stuck in there.
Yeah, they did. And Nicky Pedersen makes the start initially. He runs to the middle of the track, and that opens the door for Janowski. But more importantly, for Thomas H. Jonasson, who comes charging through from third place and gets himself to the front as they go down the back straight. Disappointment for Iversen here, because he's failed to score. And although he's got 8 points, hasn't won a race, so probably won't make the semi-finals. As Thomas H. Jonasson comes through into the lead, it's Janowski in second place, Pedersen coming through into second, and then Pedersen's boys having a good look on. It's a tight, close, competitive heat, this, in difficult conditions. Janowski rides well here, comes on strong, never throws the towel in behind Nicky Pedersen, and finally the Polish rider gets the better of the Dane and comes through into second place and takes that 2 points away from the Danish rider. But Thomas H. Jonasson, who's had a difficult Grand Prix campaign, well, a heat win's a heat win. 7 points won't be enough, I don't think, but hey, nonetheless, 3 points to his name.
Yeah, just check the forecast again, and it did say that if there was any rain, it was going to come in at 10 o'clock tonight, so it's hit us a little bit earlier. The worrying factor is it doesn't look like it's going to stop, Kelvin. That is a concern. Can we get through two more heats to take us to heat 20? And here we go with heat number 19. It's Matty Zegar from Cas Podzoukes, Chris Holder and Troy Batchelor. And through all the rain and the tricky conditions, there are vital World Championship points on the line here.
Absolutely are, and Zegar's had a disappointing night. The two Australian boys on gate 3 and 4 have been looking really good. Batchelor in particular on the outside with 10 points to his name has been flying.
Lovely start from Holder off gate number 3. Really worked the bike beautifully there. The man in red is Zegar. Now Holder. Well, this is a terrific ride from Chris Holder. From gate number 3, he was absolutely magnificent. It looked as though the bike was snaking away. He got the setup just about right, and he has the lead here from Zegar in second. Third place in yellow is Troy Batchelor. This will put Batchelor onto 11, but a big ride here from Holder will put him onto 10 points and turn his night around.
Yeah, and Holder once again enjoying a good night here. As you rightly say, Nigel, the bike really drove nicely out of gate 3 and really dug in, and he got the better of Zegar, and he looks pretty good out in front. A little bit uncomfortable there, but he's hanging on. Zegar looks pretty smooth in second place, but he hasn't enjoyed a very good night, so it won't be enough for him. Batchelor coming under pressure from Podsuks, but with a lap to go, you've got to believe that Holder should hang on here.
Yeah, got a lovely style, hasn't he, Chris Holder? But Zegar is really giving it a go. The crowd are rallied by Cas Podsuks, having a go on Batchelor at the back here. This is for a point. Chris Holder's going to take the chequered flag, and three big points for Chris Holder. Second was Matty Zegar, and Batchelor holds on for third. Every point absolutely priceless with the rain pouring down here in Daugavpils now. It does look as though it's getting heavier too. And we've had 19 heats. Once we get to heat 20, every rider will have completed five rides. And then I'm convinced there will have to be some sort of decision as to whether they press ahead with the semi-finals or call it there and then. Because we've got one race to go of the regular 20. Anyway, good ride from Chris Holder. Did all the hard work from the start. Second place there went to Matty Zegar.
Yeah.
And third was Troy Batchelor. But a good ride from Holder. Rode the bike beautifully away from the start.
Well, that's it. That was the key to his performance. He made a really good start. I don't think he enjoyed it, really. But the bike, absolutely fabulous. Got lots of grip, and he was able to dominate the first corner. Zegar there, just momentarily, he gets his nose in front from the inside. And the Slovenians actually had a really disappointing night. I thought that Zegar would actually really relish this big fast track, but it hasn't been to his liking, and the bike just clearly not working as he would have liked. Holder, of course, beginning to get some confidence back. Late on in the race, Podsuk coming on strong with Batchelor, who started so well. He moves on to 11. You can see the rain coming down there, and the track conditions just beginning to deteriorate a bit. But Chris Holder, all credit to him,
yeah,
10 points. That's a really good effort.
Very much so. Well done, Chris Holder. Superb. Now, what can this man do? Woffenden. If we are to go to the semi-finals tonight, with the rain coming down, by the way, if we are to go to the semi-finals, I reckon Woffenden needs a race win here, or he won't make it. And Hancock goes off the inside. Greg Hancock, the reigning champion, on 7 points. Gate number two in blue is Chris Harris on four. Ty Woffenden, gate three in white. And Michael Jepsen-Jensen off the outside in yellow.
Well,
now, what is the attitude of these boys now, Kelv? This is heat 20, and the rain is getting heavier.
Well, they're at tapes night, so the race looks like it's going to go ahead. And the attitude has to be, because Woffenden and Hancock in particular, you know, they are in good, strong positions in the World Championship, and they'll be pushing for a win here. Woffenden in particular, if you can get your nose in front when the rain's pouring down, then you've got a massive advantage with the dirt flying behind. Harris was very impressive in the rain last time, so don't rule him out. But Hancock on the inside has to be in the box seat.
Yeah, Hancock has to be the favourite with his super smooth starting here. But Woffenden off gate three, which is where Holder was in the previous race. And it's a great start from Hancock, as we expected. Oh, and Harris has packed up. Harris is out of the race, and now Woffenden comes round into second place to get the better of Michael Jepsen-Jensen. But Greg Hancock, super start from the inside gate, which is exactly as we thought he might do. Woffenden holding on to second, Jepsen-Jensen third, and Chris Harris's night is over by pulling in on the infield.
Yeah, I think a chain broke there as he got to the first corner for Harris. It was tight between him and Woffenden, and looked like the rear chain may have come off. But great stuff from Hancock, the inside gate was working brilliantly for him. Got to say, Woffenden in second place. This will put him on to eight, won't it, Nige?
Yes, it will.
Don't know if that's going to be enough. It's going to be awfully tight with riders on 8 points, and a lot of them. But out in front, 7 points before this race, the world champion, that'll move on to 10. He will make it, even though he's had two punches this evening.
I think Woffenden will make it ahead of Iversen, because Iversen hasn't won a race tonight.
Good point.
So that could well be the deciding factor, if indeed we do have any semi-finals, because the rain is still coming down. But huge credit to Greg Hancock. He's had two punctures tonight, but he's just pulled off a win in heat 20 to finish on 10 points from his regular rides. Superb effort from Greg Hancock of the USA. Second place Woffenden, third Jepsen-Jensen. But quite clearly, conditions are now treacherous here at Daugavpils, and we have concluded 20 heats. And it has to be now a question of whether we do go any further into the semi-finals. We will, of course, keep you posted here, trackside here in Daugavpils. But overall now we see Hancock the winner, Woffenden second, Jepsen-Jensen third. That was the result of heat number 20. And it looks very much as though Janowski leads the scorers now going into the semi-finals, if we do have semi-finals.
Well, it's not unsafe, and I've got to say that although we are having some heavy rain, riders are coping with it very well, in actual fact. I think it will become under discussion. We're seeing the rerun, of course, of Hancock coming up with a terrific win, and the world champion showing some great composure here. He's been under a massive pressure. Just see the sparks flying on Harris's bike with the chain just letting go there. That's a desperate situation for him, particularly as he won last time out, and that's a great shame for him. Woofenden, who's been struggling with the setup. Yeah, Harris's bike, the just chain lets go. There's nothing untoward with contact from another rider that's caused that. That's a shame for him. But Hancock, 10 points. That's a great return when you consider he had a zero and dropped another point, but the rain's coming down, and that really is making it
I can't see semi-finals going ahead in this rain, Kelvin, can you? Well, you can call a result now. Everybody's had five rides. It's a satisfactory conclusion if you can't stage the semis in the final. Would
yeah,
you not
I can't
agree?
Disagree with that. Can't disagree with that. So you can see now that the material on the outside has gone very watery, and you can see the grading there. The race director, of course, Phil Morris, may consider a delay and see how it works out. 9 points the difference between Woofenden and Pedersen right now. Hancock, of course, battling hard, moves on to 49 with Everson on 43. It'll be interesting to see how it all pans out for the semi-finals, if we are to have them, because there must be at least three riders on 8 points, at the very least.
Yeah, it's fascinating.
Well, there are four riders in actual fact on 8 points, and it does appear that Nils Christian Iversen's the one to miss out, because
which
he
is what I suspected in the
race.
Yeah,
exactly. He's the one that hasn't managed to win a race.
Well, look at this track now, Kelvin. They're making a real mess of this now. Unfortunately, they're trying to pull the dirt back, but it's just getting to slop now, isn't it?
It is slop on the outside, and as
they're
I
trying
say,
to pull that back to the inside.
Yeah, as any delay now with the rain continuing, and it looks like it's set in for the evening. So, I fear for the semi-finals.
Well, we will of course keep you updated here in Daugavpils. Confirm the top eight for you very shortly, just in case we do have the semi-finals. Just waiting for confirmation of the top eight here in Daugavpils, but there are members of the crowd heading for cover.
Well, the back straight grandstand is emptied because it is there's no roof, so those punters there are getting completely soaked. You have to feel for them, and the ones on the lower part of the tier on the start and finish straight also will be feeling the full effects of the rain. But that rain looks like it's well and truly set in, and that's a great shame, because it looks like it's going to curtail proceedings here, and that'll be a great shame, because it was building up quite nicely.
Confirmation of the semi-finalists now then. We know that Everson misses out because he didn't win a race. And it means that Woffenden sneaks in there. Janowski the leader. Pedersen and Batcher on 11. Holder on 10 with Hancock. Doyle, Woffenden and Kilderman on 8. Everson just misses out.
Well, Everson went into his last race on 8 points, but unfortunately for him, with the rain coming from the outside, he just couldn't get amongst the points. One solitary point would have been the difference for him, and he may well have crept in. They're getting prepared for the semi-finals here. Certainly riders are being called forward for semi-finals. Magic Janowski's there, ready to go, so who knows, we may well see some more action here this evening. Janowski, who has ridden nicely, inherited a win, of course, when Greg Hancock had that puncture, and then subsequently backed it up with another race win and then a second. So he's been rock solid this evening, just dropping 3 points. Gate one must be favourite now for the semi-finals, I would have thought. But Janowski, after a very disappointing Cardiff, has managed to win his national championship, and then this evening has had a really good performance to move himself on to 12 points. So,
yeah, very much so. Rain's still coming down, but we are told that they are lining themselves up for the for the pick for the semi-final.
I think it'll come down to riders now. Riders have been told to get up there, but whether they actually pull their helmet and goggles on to actually race in the semi-finals may be another thing. I do hope so, but conditions aren't improving, are they?
No.
No surprise to see Yanofsky go for the inside gate. And that's the shortest way. Chris Holder, who made a great start in his last ride out of gate three and quite clearly has fond memories of that and has gone for that again in his first semi-final. Jason Doyle, who has made hard work of it, but he goes from gate two and he'll be looking to try and get away. And Ty Wolfenden from the outside with nothing to lose, really. Hasn't had the best of nights, but has been hanging in there by the skin of his teeth in reality. So the first semi-final, Yanofsky off the inside, Doyle, gate two, Wolfenden on the outside, and Chris Holder coming off his choice of gate three. No surprise to see Pedersen. Pedersen off the inside in semi two.
The rain has eased slightly. It's just gentle drizzle right now.
Troy Batchelor, who's had a decent night, started with three consecutive wins. He's going to go for gate three as well. Batchelor, same choice as Holder made for the first semi-final. No surprise to see Hancock immediately going for gate two. And Peter Kilderman will go from the outside. So Peter Kilderman, you know, he's a tenacious man, isn't he? You know, somehow
won't give up, will he?
He won't give up. Semi-final two, Pedersen on the inside, Hancock alongside him, Batchelor in three, and Peter Kilderman going from the outside.
Now, the biggest question now is, when will we get on with the semi-finals? Because with every passing minute, you do worry that the track is going to deteriorate. If we are going for it, then the boys are going to have to get on with it now.
Well, we haven't seen anybody fall off. We haven't seen anything that would suggest that it's dangerous. I'm playing devil's advocate here, you know what I mean? And the fact is that I appreciate very, very, very much that the rain is continuing to come down and conditions will be deteriorating at every passing moment. But quite clearly, the organisers wanted the riders to draw for the semi-finals and they want the meeting to continue and get to its conclusion with the big final. But whether that happens, I still think is in the balance.
Okay, we shall see. We'll keep you right updated as soon as there's any news coming from the pits area. We know the lineups for the semi-finals now here in Daugavpils. And drizzle coming down. That's what it is at the moment, it's drizzle. And whilst that is the case, you could argue the track maybe won't deteriorate too much further.
This anyway. Material is it's not heavy, so it won't go too nasty. It's fairly slick and the base of the track is quite smooth, but now you just sense that there is a little bit of a hesitation. Riders are just beginning to make their way back towards their equipment, the top eight. But it will be interesting to see how they react, because there has been the inevitable delay for the picks for the semi-finals. Kind of, you know, that's the way the meeting works. One or two riders just having a quick look at conditions, walking out onto the bottom corner where the pits are based. That's Troy Batchelor. It's not as bad as some places would have been with different type of material, I've got to say that.
Okay, well, we may well see it. We are being told the latest information is that they are not going to race the semi-final until the rain eases. That is the information we're getting from the pits area.
If you look at the sky,
the riders are happy to race, but they will just want to see the rain ease up. So that really is a question of how long is a piece of string.
That to me spells that we might well be at the end, because there's no break in the cloud at all, and if we wait for 10 or 15 minutes, I'm looking at the floodlights. I'm looking at the floodlights, and to be perfectly honest, it's raining as hard as it has at any other time. So I do think that the decision has to be that you either continue on immediately, or if we have a delay now, the track will only deteriorate further, and then riders won't be at all interested in continuing.
It's just got heavier again now.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. Very unfortunate. That is now pouring. It's pouring with rain now.
Well, I'm no expert on a speedway track at all, but the way the rain is pouring down now, it's not going to do this circuit any good whatsoever.
No, I think it unlikely, very unlikely, unless we wait for a considerable period of time and then We wait for it to pass through, but I must say it looks, when I'm looking around the stadium and out the back of the stadium, it does look very well set in. So terrible shame, because it's a super track, good crowd, good atmosphere, and was building up nicely.
Yep. I just wonder whether we might be able to get an update down in the pits area, but
I'm talking on it now.
The rain. You're talking on it now, Steve. Yes, indeed, you are indeed.
Hello, hello,
yes,
gents.
Indeed,
yeah,
Steve.
I believe that where you're set, I can see you from down in the pit lane, and it's definitely drier where you are than where I am at the minute. The great news for everyone is that, as you've said in commentary, the riders. No one said they want the meeting called off. They all want to run the semi-finals, and they all want to run a final. But as you can see, and as you can probably hear on the roof. It is fair to say it's pelting down at the moment, and it just wouldn't be worth trying to run a race in this. It just wouldn't work. But as we've said, they're all very keen. They're tucked in their pit boxes. They want to get this meeting to a conclusion. So, Kelvin, this one for you as a rider. This is a very difficult time for guys now, not getting too G-tuned with the chance of a Grand Prix final coming up.
Very much so, Steve. It's an opportunity for big Grand Prix points and an unexpected winner in lots of respects. But yes, you must maintain your focus, and you mustn't allow yourself, more importantly, to believe that the meeting will be called off until somebody comes along and tells you you can pack your bags and go home. So yeah, you need to just remain calm, but still in the back of your mind, you must be prepared to pull your helmet on at any moment to actually get out there and get back up to tapes.
I'd also say, fellas, that, you know, commendable that the lads want to get out there. That's brilliant for a start.
I think that's an indication of the way the track's behaved with the rain coming down, with the surface and the base of the track not having any ruts or holes in it. So,
but how long will it take to become waterlogged? That's the question.
Because well, it's slowing, coming down heavily. The rain is definitely a lot slowing down, guys, but it's quite interesting at this point. I would suggest the most relaxed looking guy in the pit lane is Greg Hancock, because he's seen it all, done it all. And I'm just wondering now whether his level of experience of just being able to keep dialed in, keep the focus, might just be an opportunity for Greg to make a real big march tonight.
Well, you might well be right. He's quite clearly a very experienced rider. And there's no doubt that he will be more than capable of coping with any conditions that are thrown at him. But there's no doubt that the longer the rain keeps coming down this heavily, the less chance there is of racing continuing. We do need for it to ease sooner rather than later, Steve, because otherwise I just sense that there'll be too much surface water.
Yeah, just looking over the safety fence as you say that, Kelvin, it is now, it's not heavily sitting, but you can just see the ruts in the corners just starting to puddle now. And as you've said, the surface was very, very hard on the inside before, and all it will be now is slippery. So let's hope that the rain stops and we can get some track work done and we can see a proper conclusion to the meeting.
Yep, fingers crossed. Yep. Credit to the riders for the entertainment they've given us so far. It has been a good Grand Prix, Kelvin.
Yeah, it has, and that's a shame when the weather's come in to interrupt proceedings, because we were really building up nicely. You know, Pedersen beginning to eke into the lead that Woofenden had prior to tonight's event. He's reduced it by 3 points so far, and Woofenden's looked a little vulnerable tonight on a track that hasn't got the greatest of history on, particularly last year he didn't do so well, but he was hanging in there. So yeah, you know, it's undermining that. Chris Holder riding nicely, Peter Kilderman battling awfully hard to get that last qualifying spot, Doyle making that mistake earlier on, but recovering well, and he's in the semi-finals, and the Australians, in actual fact, all three of them making the semi-finals tonight, so a great night for Australia. But Yanofsky, got to say, after a very disappointing Cardiff, one that he would have really been disappointed about, has bounced back and has put in a really strong evening's work so far this evening, and has to, well, I'm sure he'd be really, really looking forward to trying to win his first Grand Prix.
Well, the riders out there on the track now, they'll be getting, increasingly concerned. Here's the World Championship. Ty Woffinen 63. Nicky Pedersen is 9 behind now, so he's closed the gap by 3 points tonight. Nicky Pedersen. Greg Hancock, 49. And Niels Christian Iversen on 43.
And from Woffinden's point of view, he's probably a little conflicted, because he isn't enjoying a great night. He's got gate 4 in the semi-finals. If the meeting gets called off now, in actual fact, he won't be that disappointed, because Nicky Pedersen's had the upper hand this evening and has got a better starting place for the semi-final.
Oh, Nicky's been the better rider tonight of the two. There's no question about that.
You can see the water now. Track's becoming waterlogged, and that's going to make it more and more less likely that we're going to see more racing this evening. And as I say, looking over the back of the stadium where the weather came from, it's absolutely solid, the cloud. There's no breaks in the cloud. And I fear for the rest of the meeting. I think it would be, the odds are against the meeting being completed now.
Well, the only consolation is we have had 20 heats.
Yeah.
That is a consolation. Rain still coming down. Just to remind you, if you have just joined us, that this Grand Prix here in Latvia is suffering a rain delay right now. Because as it stands, the riders are quite happy to go out for the semi-finals, but they want to see the rain ease.
Well, it's not.
And it's not.
And it's raining harder than it's ever had done at any other time. So,
although it is slightly clear, if you look over the back there, Nigel, the cloud may be breaking a fraction. So,
but is that where it's coming from?
I think so, because it was absolutely solid out the back of the stadium there a little earlier. So. Never know, it might just ease in the next 10 or 15 minutes, and the track surface is hard, so they will be able to get equipment out there to work the track, so you never know, you never know.
Maybe not all over yet.
Not just yet.
Two world champions, Chris Holder and Nicky Pedersen, having a chat. Rain still coming down then here in Daugavpils. Credit the fans as well. There's only the one part of the covered seating here on the home straight.
You can see the water bouncing off the track there. So,
but I just got a sneaking suspicion that this rain is going to move through.
And if it does, can the track be retrieved? Can it be saved?
I think so, because if it stops or eases right off. I do think this material is not that heavy, so that there must be a chance of it being able to. You can see there.
Sky's clearing, yeah.
Just over the back there.
I feel like a weatherman here.
Yeah.
The race director is giving it 5 more minutes, we're told, Phil Morris. Talking to the FIM jury, and they are going to give it 5 more minutes, which would take us to 9:15 here, Latvian time. I wonder if that's because Phil Morris believes that the track can only take 5 more minutes rain.
Well, I don't believe, I think that's unlikely.
What are we going to get, Kelv? If it stops, what are we going to get? We're going to get guys trying to just scrape the top surface off completely?
It is going to stop raining, I do know. In the next 20-odd minutes, it will stop raining here. And there, then, they need to be able to move that surface water and the top layer of material away.
Which will leave concrete.
Yes, and that won't be easy, but...
If you were a semi-finalist now, what would you be feeling?
I'd be feeling very nervous about the conditions I was going to be facing, but I would have to remain of a mind that I was going to continue to race. I have to be prepared to go to the tapes, because until somebody says it's off, there is always that possibility that you're going to have to go up and watch the green light come on.
Standing water all over the first and second turn now.
Yeah. But I'm not saying it's great, but what I do know is if they call it off in the next 5 minutes, there is a distinct possibility 10 minutes later it won't be raining here.
Yep, so quite clearly it is a question of how much more rain can the track take. Phil Morris making that call that he'll give it until 9:15 before making a decision. But the sky is clearing behind turns 3 and 4.
And you might well be right, because there's just quite possibly a little bit too much surface water now.
Right, let's hear from Greg Hancock with Steve Brandon.
Greg, we can see the other riders having a chat, and we can see what's happening with the track with the rain at the minute. But the first question for you is just, you have to really keep focus now, because this meeting probably will, and they'll try and get to the end if they can.
Yeah, you got that right. I mean, when the rain comes like this, it's a shame, but it also is where you got to plan and make a few adjustments kind of accordingly and try to make it work.
And the other big thing is 6 points in the World Championship at stake for you guys.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, that's the most important thing for everybody right now. So we've always got to take into consideration the weather and the safety part of it, but we're all chasing points too.
And for you tonight, a couple of blips, but pretty solid.
Yeah, I'm really happy. You know, I mean, it's you can't help having these little pieces of bad luck, but it's racing, and we're all at a high level, and we're all trying to make, you know, that little bit extra of an edge.
I'll let you get back to the pit bay. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Yeah, he's done remarkably well tonight, Hancock. He dropped 4 points with the two punches, but still managed to battle his way through to 10.
Kelvin, and I'm just stood with my head outside the commentary box. It is pouring down.
Yeah, I don't doubt that at all.
I'm coming back in now.
Well done. A bit chilly out there as well. All credit to these people that have shown a lot more character than you, Nigel. They've been out there for a while now. But the problem is the frustration will be here, Nigel. If the meeting gets called off now or in the next 5 or 10 minutes, I've got a distinct feeling that it will stop raining fairly soon.
But it's a question of whether they can get the track into
exactly
a rideable condition.
The damage may well be done, and that will mean that it's too much work. That will take far too long.
Well,
to
there are people leaving the stadium, Kelv. There's people leaving the stadium on the apex of the first and second turn now.
Well, they want to get out of the rain, don't they?
Yeah, they feel as though it's all over. So,
but I tell you, Nigel, if the meeting gets called off fairly soon, reasonably soon after that, the rain will stop. Now, whether the equipment and the expertise of the track staff here can sort of relay this track within a relatively short period of time, then the drainage seems decent. It'll be interesting to see.
Well, I do believe we have some news now down in the pits with Steve Brandon.
Yeah, what I can tell you guys is Phil Morris and Torben Olsen, the operations director from BSI Speedway, are out on the track at the moment having a look. And I've just been told that they're hoping there is some dry weather coming, as we can see the light skies. And at the moment, we're going to wait for another 10 to 15 minutes. But there are some quite big puddles emerging on what I can see on turn four now. So we'll just have to wait, play the waiting game and see what happens from here.
So we're going for another 10 or 15 minutes now. But there are people leaving the stadium. There are people that have actually left the exit gate on the apex of the first and second turn. They have left.
Well, they may be leaving too early, because
it does look as though the rain is easing now.
It does, and it will stop raining in the next 10 or 15 minutes as well, because that real black cloud has now moved away from the stadium, and it's followed by broken skies. So, although it hasn't stopped just yet, I do believe in the next 10 or 15 minutes, the rain will ease sufficiently for them to possibly start working on the track. It just depends whether the surface water is, they need to wait too long for that and they can't move it, because that right now is the major challenge for them.
It does appear as though it is coming over here, the drier weather for sure.
Yeah.
With you 100% on that, Kelv. But, just looking at the... just looking at the racing surface now, with all that water on it, what is it going to be like if they do some track work on it? What sort of track are we going to have for the semis and the final of a World Championship Grand Prix?
Yeah,
that is the big concern, isn't it?
It is a concern, and it's still raining, and it's not improving yet. But the material here is not heavy, so they can move it relatively easily. The biggest challenge will be the surface water and the spray. Riders won't relish that at all, and if they can't get rid of that, then the meeting won't continue. But if it stops and they believe and they have confidence in the equipment they've got here, then I think we will see semi-finals and a final.
So, quite simply, Kelv, the equipment that you need is a blade to clear the surface water off the track.
Yes, absolutely, and it's not heavy here, Nigel, it's sandy, so they won't have too much trouble with that. And if the drains can cope with this amount of water, you might find that the water disappears relatively quickly, and it might just surprise us. I think it's a long shot, but when you look at it there, that can't. Oh, when you look at it there, crikey, oh dear. There's me trying to remain positive.
You are. You're very positive. I'm the doom and gloom merchant.
Yeah,
here.
You're
the one who's all upbeat and positive.
I want to see three more races, but
I only want to see them if the track is good, is safe and good for racing,
yeah,
not just riding.
I hear that.
You know?
I hear that. But
it's getting heavier again now.
It's a tough call for Phil Morris, because I just get the distinct feeling that when he calls it off, it's going to stop raining.
Anyway, we're going around in circles talking like this, aren't we?
Well, riders do all the time, don't they? That's
they
what
do.
They get paid for.
Absolutely,
so
yeah.
We're sort of adopting their line. Mm. Next week, Melilla is a great meeting, of course.
Yeah, looking forward to that.
Looking forward to that. Yeah. It's in the middle of a wood, but that doesn't take anything
away. It's a
great
racetrack,
isn't it? It's a fabulous racetrack, and we've seen some really good stuff there, and it will be a great Grand Prix. Fingers crossed we don't get rain there. We've had a World Cups there. We've had plenty of Grand Prix, and it's a track I think, by and large, riders really look forward to going to. It's a proper racing track.
Yep. Well, here... has to be said that this downpour now could well be the final nail in the coffin.
Well,
if
we've
you
got
like.
Tractors
so
now
getting
emerging.
Tractors out now, but it's still raining. The jury president and the race director are discussing in the pits now, but I'm just trying to work out why the plant equipment is coming out here when it's still raining.
Yeah, well, the guy running across the centre green is now sending them back.
Well, here's Wolfgang Glass, who is the jury president.
The referee.
The referee is Marek Wojciech, and the race director is Phil Morris. But do you really see what this is achieving now, Kelv, this track work?
Nothing. Nothing. The decision, I think, has been made. The three officials are now leaving the track.
Well, the decision might have been made to wait another 5 minutes.
Possibly.
Yeah.
The thing that's probably just... keeping the hopes alive is the fact that the track is firm underfoot.
Yeah.
It's not soft, and there aren't any really nasty ruts out there that have caused riders to lose control. Tractors are sort of gently going down the back straight, but they aren't grading. They haven't lowered the gear behind the tractors, so right now they're being told to wait just a little bit. Work can't really commence on a track until it stops raining, and even then it may be too late. Maybe too late.
But the rain is still heavy. That's the problem. It is pouring down, really. There's no getting away from it.
Yeah, I thought it might have stopped by now, but it hasn't. So, yeah, there's a tough call, you know. They obviously are giving it every chance possible. Riders have played along as well. There's been no real stance from riders saying, nope, we're not going on. But you just sense that Phil Morris now is looking around him. It doesn't look great.
Well, I think the only hope that they've had, and the reason why they've held on to this, is because of the clear skies emerging behind the third and fourth turn. If those skies weren't clear there, that break in the cloud there,
it'd be off.
Maybe it had been off by now.
It would have been off. It would have been off. And that's just given them the encouragement to sort of just hang on for a minute. But the rain has lingered longer than they would have wanted. And every moment that goes by now and the rain is still relatively heavy.
I think they've just shook hands here.
You've got to believe the meeting's going to be called off.
I think they've just tried to get a tractor on the track. They've tried to do some grading. And I think they've just shaken hands here. But that's not for me to say. We'll wait for any official decision, but...
Will Magic Yanofsky then declared the winner of the Grand Prix?
Yes, 12 points. Well, it's gone too far, hasn't it, Kelvin? Has that not gone too far?
Yes, if it continues to rain, there's no question that we can go on. Officials and riders are now making their way back to the pits, and I sense it may have been called off.
Well, it does mean that Mats Ionowski has won the Grand Prix. He's celebrating. He's been told the meeting is abandoned after 20 heats. And Mats Ionowski is winner of the Latvian Grand Prix. Many congratulations to him. Ionowski the winner. And he has just recorded his first ever Grand Prix victory.
Yeah,
Mats Ionowski.
Yeah, absolutely. Not the ideal way to win it, I'm sure. And he'll have a smile on his face, but I'm sure he would have preferred to have done it. In the big final, picking up the big prize, but nonetheless, he's been solid throughout the night and done a decent job. We've got tractors coming around in front of us, and there's no question that conditions are really quite difficult out there, and it is still raining relatively hard.
Let's hear from the race director, Phil Morris, with Steve Brandon.
Phil Morris, 20 heats of speedway, some great night of action, but unfortunately the weather's beaten us.
Yeah, the guys are really good. You know, we got through from heat 16 to 20 in bad weather, and the guys sort of, we spoke about it, they're all ready to go, but they said, can we just, if the rain stops a bit, they were happy to go, but it's just got heavier and heavier, and now there's 1-inch puddles on the track. I think it's gone past being sensible, so we've made a decision to call the event off.
Yeah, I think it's very sensible. Everyone can see looking at it. Your surface water is the enemy of speedway, and it's just not possible to race on that.
Yeah, the guy that makes a gate probably be okay, but the three behind him probably won't be able to see. And yeah, it's not great, but we managed to get to 20, and especially the last four heats, the guys put it in, especially in the rain. So unfortunately, sorry to the fans and the people watching, but we've made a sensible decision.